Hey, this is Betsy, and you're listening to Your Morning Manna, the best Monday morning wake-up show. Did you know that every week there's a challenge issued?
And now, this week's Joy Challenge.
Right here on Your Morning Manna, every Monday morning a Joy Challenge is offered. Tune in to see how you can bring joy to your world.
You have been challenged. Now go out and spread joy.
Does this bring you joy? Me neither. How about this? This is Paul from your Morning Manna crew. Join us here on WCC from 8 to 10 a.m. on Monday mornings, where we guarantee to bring you joy.
This is Jim Hanna of Ah Sunshine. My wife Anita and I have over 25 years experience in the decorated apparel industry. Ah Sunshine is a Christian-based, family-owned business that offers screen printing, embroidery, promotional products, signs, vinyl decals, and vehicle wrap. We offer fast, friendly service at a reasonable price. At Ah Sunshine, all customers are treated like family. Our goal is to develop a relationship that will last a lifetime. You may reach us on the web at ahsunshine.com or call us at 803-226-0532. That's 803-226-0532. Spreading God's love one order at a time here at Ah Sunshine.
You are listening to WUCC 99.9 FM, a station dedicated to preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ 24 hours a day.
Hey, this is Jace Turner. Be sure to join the Morning Manna crew every Monday morning from 8 to 10 a.m. right here on God's radio station, 99.9 FM.
Hey there, thank you for listening to 99.9 FM. Because of our loyal listeners, we are able to share truth, like on Mondays with Morning Manna. Sowing into this ministry helps spread the word of Jesus Christ, and your financial support makes it possible to send the truth around the world. Thank you for listening to WUCC, and God bless.
You're listening to Your Morning Manna.
Does this sound familiar? If you ever find yourself in this situation, be sure to call A1 Bonding and Enterprises. This is a family-owned Christian business that is here to help. Call their Aiken office at 803-642-5190. That's 803-642-5190. And you can tell them you heard about them on Your Morning Manna.
Hi, this is Dana Turner with All About You Hair and Nail Salon. And we are proud sponsors of Your Morning Manna. Listen every Monday from 8 to 10 a.m. right here on 99.9 FM, the Voice of Truth Station.
Hey, CSRA, if your lawn is in need of some TLC, how about giving Tony of Riverfront Lawn Care a call at 803-257-5832. That's 803-257-5832. And remember, they always give you more for your money.
Hi, this is Dana. Be sure to check us out every Monday morning from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. for the Morning Manna Show right here on 99.9 FM WUCC.
Hey y'all, this is April with Morning Manna Crew, and I just want to invite you to listen to us on Monday mornings from 8 to 10 a.m. here on WUCC Live.
Saddle up your horses!
Good morning. It's time to saddle up for your weekly ride with Morning Manna and the Morning Manna Crew. Good morning, CSRA. We are so happy and blessed to be back. We are live and in the studio. Thank you, Jesus. And we can't wait to do Your Morning Manna again this fine moist Monday.
I know, right? Yeah. I'm excited to be here, though.
Yeah, because we hadn't been here in a while, so we're bear with us because we're getting used to the studio again.
I know.
And we've already had some technical difficulties, so if you're listening live via the radio, if we're a little bit low, we apologize. We're trying to figure that out right now.
Figure out why it's so low. I don't have a clue.
But if you listen to us live on Facebook, we're glad to have you. We'd love to be back with you.
I probably got the wrong one up.
Turn four on.
Four. Sorry. Wrong one.
There we go.
Yes. Now
I
can hear you.
What is going on? Okay.
Oh,
goodness.
So, yeah, we just knocking some rust off. It's all good.
Well, y'all do realize we have not been out here in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so, it's longer for me.
Yeah. Yeah. And longer for us.
Yeah. Because I can't remember. Because last time I was supposed to come, we didn't. Then mm-hmm. the time for that, I was supposed to come. He didn't. Mm-hmm. And we ended up not coming.
Yeah.
So it's been a while.
It's been a while. Yeah. But anyway, I'm just glad to be here. We've got a good program today lined up. We've got lots to talk about.
Yes.
You know, we got a lot going on in our world. So we just come to bring y'all some joy this morning.
Amen. Joy.
Bring some laughter.
Joy.
So no one will call and turn us in. We are practicing 6 foot in between.
Our social distancing, mm-hmm. right?
Now, the one thing we are doing is, since me and Dana are from the same household, and Sean and his lovely daughter is from the same household, we're counting each other as just two people.
You're on the camera.
Wave,
you don't have to say anything, but you can wave.
Wave at the camera.
This is Sean's baby.
That's my baby. Yep. Yeah.
She must take after her mama.
Yeah. She gets it after her daddy. Daddy's real shy and reserved.
Yeah, I can tell that, right?
Yeah. Introvert.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Well, we've got a lot to cover this morning, so let's just go ahead and open up with prayer, and then we're going to do some shout outs on Facebook and get going.
Father, we just love you today, and we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, Lord God, for how you just blessed us through everything that's been going on. Lord, I praise you for keeping the storms at bay. Mm-hmm. Lord, I just thank you, Lord God, for your goodness and all you've done. Lord, I just can't thank you enough. Lord, a lot of times we come before you with wanting this and wanting that and needing this and touching that, Lord, but I just want to praise you this morning, God. I want to give you thanks and glory for all you've done. Lord, you are so good. Lord, I just thank you, Lord God, for all of our healthcare workers and all those who have been out on the front lines, Lord, during this pandemic, God. And I just pray, Lord God, that you will continue to bless them and strengthen them, God. Yes, God, I give you praise, God, for every minister, Lord, that's been out trying to just find new ways to minister, Lord, whether it's through Facebook Live or radio or, you know, however, drive-in services, whatever they're doing.
Yes, Jesus.
Lord, I pray you encourage them, God, and you strengthen them. Lord, I just thank you, Lord God, for who you are.
Yes.
God, you are the light of our life, God.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, I just thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity for us to gather together today to spread joy,
Lord,
to our listeners. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord. And I just pray, God, something said, God, something done on this show today will touch hearts and lives, Lord.
Yes.
That, God, they will just bring joy to them, God, and let them see in the midst of all this stuff going on that you are still God, that you are still on the throne, and that you're still reigning over all this stuff. And Lord, we just give you praise and glory for it. In your name we pray.
Amen.
I wanted to read these two scriptures. My wife, since all this stuff has been going on, my wife actually has written these scriptures down and has posted it on both bathroom medicine cabinet window mirrors.
Right.
And it's Psalms 91, 9 and 10 and 11, I think is what it is. And it says, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways.
Amen.
And that's something that we constantly say at our home.
We were talking about that on the way out here. Because I'm one of the, you know, I have
health issues that this virus will affect me more so than other people. But it hadn't, you know, I still go out. I do what I have to do.
Right.
You know, I'm not worried about it, but at the same time, I'm not trying to tempt God.
Right. Exactly.
And it's like, well, you know, we pray Psalm 91 over us each day. And
I tell him every morning, I said, Lord, you said that no plague shall come near my dwelling.
Right.
This is my dwelling right here.
Amen.
And and I just walk out, I said, you either believe what the word says or you don't.
Exactly.
I mean, there's, you know, there's no gray area there.
Exactly.
So. Before we get started good, I want to give a shout out, number one, to Jeffrey Hicks.
Jeffrey,
he's a friend of Your Morning Manna and, you know, personal friend of ours. We love him.
We got to get him on the calendar.
Yeah, we love him to life.
I love Jeffrey.
He's got an open invitation to come out here anytime.
For sure.
People need to realize in this time, Jeff is a traveling evangelist.
Yes.
Right.
You know, he gets love offerings to go here, there, and everywhere.
Right.
This time, you know, people, I'm assuming, are not calling him. So we need to remember the evangelist in our lives.
Yes, absolutely.
And if you are an essential worker or, you know, or independently wealthy or whatever, send them some love.
Yeah, if you look up Jeffrey Hicks either on Facebook or on, I think he has a website. But
yeah, Jeffrey Hicks Ministry.
Yeah, he has like a PayPal type deal or something. Right. That you could sow into his ministry. Yeah. And,
absolutely.
And I encourage you to do that.
Because you'll be blessed, for sure.
Also, our dear friend Chris Brooks.
Yes. Right.
I talked to him this week.
I was about to get to him, too.
And, you know, they're doing the same thing. You know, they have had to cancel meetings and different things because of all this.
And Chris Brooks is the one that started the drive-in church
service. Yeah, that we were.
You know, yeah.
He was one of the first ones I saw personally. Yeah. I was like, well, that's a great idea.
Well, you know, guys, talking about this kind of makes me think of, and Bill and I've talked about this, I had to close down my salon, which a lot of other people had to close their businesses. And I said, you know, this is where the rubber meets the road.
Mm-hmm.
You're either going to walk believing God's going to take care of you.
Amen.
Or not.
Yeah, because when, you know, we got the word from the governor, salons be shut down. I mean, that's half of our household income.
Right.
And I mean, there was no, oh my God, what are we going to do to it? It was, okay, well, you know, we'll get through it. It'll all be good.
I told Bill when all of this first started and everything in the pandemic, and you see everybody running around, you know, fearful and scared or whatever, there has been a very strange, it's been a peace and a calm in my own spirit, you know, like not worried about it. It's like the first time in my life, I can't depend on my salon to make my car payments now or my rent or whatever. I've got to trust God.
That's right.
And he hasn't failed me yet. He's come through in different ways that, you know, and so he's proved himself over and over again. But, you know, it's hard when you start thinking about that and they tell you they're closing down your livelihood. It was like to me, the Lord says, who are you going to trust?
Susan Collins just posted on here that Jeffrey Hicks is going to join them in Bamberg for one service.
All right.
Praise the Lord. Sunday coming. Jeffrey, I'll be in church the same time, but man, if we could after church sometime hook up, man, I'm not too terribly far from you. I'd love to see you and just hang out for a few minutes. Maybe we'll get together and we can handle that, but that's good stuff. Yeah, and what you were just saying, I preached yesterday about, you know, hope and faith. And one thing's for sure, and I know as a pastor, and I'm not judging people. Lord knows I'm not that kind of pastor. But I told my people yesterday, this right here, this stuff the last few weeks will bring out either your faith or it'll show your fears.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of people has allowed fear to dominate instead of their faith to overcome.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And it'll rise to the top. You can tell the people who have faith, they don't care. You know, they're like, Jesus got me. You know? I mean, they're being precautious. That's what we got to do.
Right.
You know, but we're not, you know, overly worried about it. You know, but there are some people who are deathly afraid.
Yeah, they'll wear a mask inside their own car.
Right.
By themselves.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and you know, this, that, and the third. I did something this past week that was probably the most weird. I reckon weird is the right word. I don't know if that's weird or not. But anyway, we had to partake in a funeral, which, you know, was an honor to be asked to do that by all means. But, you know, it was like they had sign out there, no, you know, no hugging, no, you know, all this and that. I'm at a funeral, you know, that's what I do. And I hugged a few of them. I said, y'all, I don't care. If you don't care, I don't care.
Right.
You know, I mean, this time
you were being irresponsible.
I'm sorry, boy. I just, at that time, you know, this is a time when people need that, you know. But they could only have a graveside service. You could only have so many people there.
Right.
And they had the chairs spaced out. The funeral home would not provide chairs. They had to bring their own chairs because I reckon because of the sanitation or whatever. I don't know. I never heard of that before.
Bring your lawn chairs and come on out.
Yeah, it was just,
it's crazy.
It's crazy. You know,
bring me down just a little bit. I'm redlining.
It's crazy, and it was just weird. It was very weird. But
how's that changed your service?
We're doing weather permitting. We're doing drive-in services.
Okay.
I think I saw you had a tractor trailer.
Yeah, it's a farm trailer, like a hay trailer, gooseneck out there. And we first did it without it, and I was on the ground, you know, and then we had three and four lines of cars, and people couldn't see me.
Right.
So we brought that in.
Right.
And
it's always
better. We've had great turnouts. I mean, yesterday we probably had 150 people.
Okay, I'm hearing somebody talking.
Yeah,
I'm hearing it too.
Well, mine's turned down. Anybody else got it?
I mean, mine's turned down.
I don't know.
Yeah, mine's turned down.
Yeah,
I don't know what's going on.
Y'all hear somebody talking. We don't know who that is.
It was switched over and there's nothing changed in
nothing.
There.
It's sounding good in there now, so
okay.
It's all good.
All right.
Anyway, but that's what we're doing. You know, when the weather's bad, I have to go live, and it's just, you know, my essential group in the church that helps me,
right?
You that's know, get things going, and that's.
Well, I've been blessed by it as far as my walk goes, because I'm watching like five services on Sunday, so I'm blessed as far as that goes. But the interaction with other Christians, I'm starved.
Me too.
Yeah.
We had the pleasure of going to see a couple people from my church. This weekend briefly, and I mean, I was like, you know, happy day.
That's what
it shows you, how we're created to
socialize.
Yeah, yeah,
we're social, you
mingle
know?
We want to be around people,
and these are people I consider friends, more so than just church friends,
right?
So it's very unusual not seeing them,
you know. It's kind of been a twofold thing. This is the way I've looked at it. I think that during this season, God has used this to draw us and draw our eyes away from a lot of things in the world and draw them back to Him, back to Him. And then at the other time, it's letting us know just how much we miss the socialization, like how much we kind of take for granted, I guess would be the best way to say it. You know, you don't think about the things that we have until they're taken away from you.
And they'll take them away.
Well, it has showed me, you know, how quickly if the Lord says stop,
things can stop.
Yes,
you know? I'm not saying the Lord brought this virus. The Lord knows I ain't saying that because I don't believe that.
I believe He allowed it.
But I believe He uses things, you know, and because He says all things work together for His good, you know, for our good. And so He's trying to, you know, I think He's using it. But I really believe that because I preached not long ago before all this happened, how we allow so many things to come before God.
Absolutely.
Know, and church. And I know a lot of people say, well, you know, church ain't God. I know. But the Bible strictly says, forsake not the assemblies of yourselves together.
Right.
Even more as you see the day approaching.
Uh-huh.
You know, what is approaching? It's approaching, you know. And I was guilty, man. Years ago, I was guilty of it. And as a matter of fact, I was telling some people, some of my band members, Saturday night, I said, you know, I almost feel like a hypocrite now because of the way I was then. But I mean, I'd find any excuse not to go to church. You know, my son was playing travel ball, and we would every weekend we'd be playing Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah, because they don't travel ball, and I don't like that. They don't respect Sunday at all.
No,
you know.
Mm-mm.
You know, to me, you should have the last game on Sunday, and it should be 2:00.
Right.
You know, after church.
Right.
But that's my opinion. Now, of course, I think if you're going to have travel ball on Sunday at 9:00 in the morning, you should have church service.
Right.
Have a pastor come out there.
Well, the thing is, too, now, since my son was in there, you have travel baseball, You have travel basketball.
Travel soccer.
They have travel soccer. You have travel volleyball. Uh-huh. You have, you know, travel softball. I mean, did I say softball? I might have did. I don't remember. But, I mean, you got all these sports that when my son was playing, it was just baseball. That's all you heard about was travel baseball. Uh-huh. Now everybody's dipped in because it's a money thing.
Yeah, because we've done volleyball, soccer, and and now baseball.
I just think the Lord had the way. You know, what the enemy meant for evil, God has turned for good.
Right.
And he's taken us back away from all the things that took our attention away. Mm-hmm. You drew our attention, even just away from family and family time. How many of you now have spent more times talking to your family and are having dinner together and times have slowed back down to when it kind of reminds me when we were growing up.
Yeah.
We didn't have all the extracurricular things going on. I mean, we had, you played in your yard.
Mm-hmm.
You had family dinners. Mm-hmm. You had, you know what I'm saying? You watched TV
friends,
together.
Your friends were your cousins.
And so, you know, I think things have a way of, what's the scripture says? There's coming nothing back. New under the sun.
Right.
And so this virus has not taken our God by surprise, by no means. And I think what the enemy planned, God has used this for a whole different playing field.
Definitely. I think it's funny because someone asked me the other day, how's it affected you? And I was like, very little, because as a shift worker, you know, I'm isolated to begin with, because a lot of times when I'm up and around,
everybody
is asleep
or whatever,
at work. So it hadn't really affected me in a socialization type.
Mm-hmm.
Except going with other crowds.
Except for church on Sunday. Now, I think at this time, it's really helped some of the pastors that were in ruts.
Yeah.
They've had to come out. And
I think they've been challenged.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, what am I, you know, cause like some of the smaller church pastors have been doing the same thing.
Right.
Well, now they're having to make a choice. Mm-hmm. What are we going to shut down? Are we going to do this internet stuff?
And I tell you, that's been, that's my father-in-law pastors a church in Walterboro. And, you know, it was right after this happened, and you know, their overseer basically, you know, like Church of God, they shut them down. Said, you know, you're not going to have it. And basically, if you have it, you're not under the umbrella of the church, you know, for protection and all that, you know. So my father-in-law said, you know, I think the first week they just didn't have service, you know, and then, you know, we were doing ours, and he said, called me and said, how do I do this Facebook Live? You know? So I told him how to do it and got everything up. So now he's doing Facebook Live every Sunday. You know, they go in, him and my sister-in-law and I don't know who else is there, but they go in and they set things up and he preaches and sings and everything, you know, like normal. But, you know, I mean, my father-in-law is 70-something years old, you know, and like you said, he's having to learn new things, you know? And it's funny because, you know, a lot of people that don't mess with this stuff all the time don't have a clue.
Right.
And at first, you know, my father-in-law and them were recording sideways.
Right.
You know, and so, you know, when you go to watch it, you'd be like, you know, all this and that, you know. So I told him, I said, Daddy, you got to make
straight
your
up.
Phone straight up, boy.
Yeah.
And anyway.
I like the live view. Don't worry.
Yeah. Yeah, but you've seen a lot of creative stuff come out of people now through all of this.
Yeah.
Even, you know, I mean, just people in general and the Facebook Lives and all the different creativeness that's come through this.
I'm surprised at the quality. Because a lot of these people, like your father-in-law, had to jump in it with both feet, you know.
Right.
And then
feet to the fire, go.
Yeah, and then within 2 weeks, they got it going on. Mm-hmm. That looks good. Mm-hmm. And sounds good.
Yeah.
So
it's been a blessing, man. We are really blessed. And I listen to Pastor Kevin Wallace from Chattanooga a lot, and he's become a good friend. And he's had several of his senior pastors that is in the Ruach Global Network. He's done Zoom calls with them. You know, we all get on there. And anyway, I was the only one out of, I don't know how many pastors was on that day, that was doing drive-in services. So he asked me to speak about it, you know.
Right.
And anyway, I listened to him, you know, every morning, and he says the same thing. We're blessed to have the technology to do what we're doing, but I can't wait to get back to my people, you know.
Well, and I think that's the way most pastors feel. Yeah. And that's the way most church people, I mean, like, I miss my brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
I've enjoyed being able to. In fact, I I told Bill and I, we were talking about yesterday, we had our day lined up. We had coffee. Mm-hmm. Like we listened to Jensen Franklin mm-hmm. first, then Christian Heritage Church mm-hmm. next, and then our pastor comes mm-hmm. on at 11. And of course, I had to be up at the church. Mm-hmm. So we've got all of those, you know, songs right there on Sunday morning.
Right.
But I miss
the fellowship
in the building and the fellowship. Well, and this is what I think is so amazing. I think through this, when we go back to church, if you ever go back to the same you had, this did not work for you.
Right.
Because
if you go back to it just being exactly that way, I hate it for you because I'm looking for the changes.
I'm so excited. I cannot wait. Have you seen some of the memes that's on Facebook that people have been
about
doing
hugging,
about their first Sunday back
they're running
to church
down the aisle. Some people tagged me in it. I tell you, I know for me as a pastor, it has been challenging because especially on the days that, even when we have the drive-in services, but even worse on the days that we don't, like on Wednesdays when I do the Facebook Live and you got three or four people in there and you're trying to preach and you're preaching to a camera and trying to, you know what I'm saying?
But you've got to get out your head. Because what you're doing is you're preaching to the masses.
Right.
You do not know
exactly
who's going to, if they're not watching it live.
But it's just
now,
weird because you're so used to having a church full of people.
Yeah,
because
the church sounds different when they go by that now.
And you get, and I'm one of these pastors, you know, because I was raised Pentecostal. I live off the feedback.
Interaction,
I want to hear some amens and some praise the Lord and come on, preach, you know.
Get you a little soundtrack.
And now I have to watch it because while I'm teaching or preaching, I'll put the live on my phone like we do here, and I'll look at the comments, you know, as it going in case it's something, you know.
That you need to address and, or whatever,
And so I'll see that preach it, and then it'll fire me up, and I'll go again, you know, or something like that.
Hold on, let me check.
Yeah, Hawaii, yay! You know? Right. But even in our drive-in services, you know, we got people, some people get out in their cars and set a chair in front of their car, you know, and stuff like that. But I just still feel so distant. I told him yesterday, I felt so distant.
Well, that's because you've got a pastor heart, and you like the interaction with your flock.
Oh, yeah, I want to love on them. And,
One thing I want to say since I see she's watching, Danette Rowe, she is a member of Christian Heritage Church. She has a very beautiful singing voice, and Christian Heritage is now on the radio station from 10 to 11 every Sunday.
Now, let's clarify that, because they've been with us straight to the point on
Wednesday
since
Pastor,
we started.
Right.
Pastor
Stephen
has been on, but now they're doing a Sunday service
that's awesome.
With us on Sunday mornings at 10.
But their first one, they allowed Danette to sing Ain't No Grave.
Mm. On Easter Sunday.
And you know, I had goosebumps, but normally the goosebumps were up around my neck. My goosebumps were from my ankles all the way up to my head.
It's awesome. If you have not had a chance to hear her sing,
and it's on Facebook, and it's on, because I think I shared it a couple times.
What a voice God's blessed her with.
Yeah,
sure.
She is definitely a blessing.
Well, let's do a few more shout outs because I see our daughter is watching, Amanda. They're watching in Milan, Indiana. I miss my baby so bad. Every time we Facebook, Jax goes, Nana, when are you coming back to my house?
Oh, man.
And if you're watching, put a comment, if it's just, hey.
Yeah,
let us know you're watching.
So we can see that you can
Mary
hear.
Hannah and Jeffrey Hicks.
That's
Claire
good to see
Porter,
Mary Hannah on.
Rachel Glanton. Let's see.
Donna King, of course.
Yeah.
I got some people, too.
All right,
so,
Teresa Fisk.
Yeah, Teresa Fisk. Jean Barnardo.
Susan Collins, you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, Chuck MacMillan.
Chet B.
Ashley Buchanan.
My uncle from Florida was watching, Jimmy Lynn. Appreciate him looking. Gwen Ryan. Bruner. I just doing that to mess with Ronnie. Sharon Gibson. Gil Hackney.
Yeah.
Good night, man.
Just take a minute to say hey.
Yeah, y'all just pop something on there. Sharon said good morning.
Yeah,
Gwen gives some hearts. My wife is on.
Right.
Yes, don't let me forget my wifey. There's my wifey right there. I love her. Did you see your baby in the back here, mama? She on that phone.
Way to mama, baby.
She probably watching a show on Netflix or something.
Yeah.
But we are here live and in studio.
Thank you, Jesus.
I just wanted to say, too, that our first things first that we did, our prayer and scripture was sponsored by Bodybuilders Ministry.
Yes.
And I don't want to leave them out because that is such a great, great ministry.
Yes.
And we appreciate all they do. And
We appreciate all our sponsors.
All our sponsors, yes.
We realize our sponsors are having a tough time because we all are, but God's got you.
Mama says she loves you, Sky.
You know, there is so much really to talk about this morning. I was just sitting here thinking things that were coming to my mind as we were sitting here. I was thinking about one of the sermons we heard yesterday that I took notes on that I've got to share this morning because I thought it was so cool since we're all kind of under house arrest or quarantine. And then talking about all the different services and the different creativeness that's coming out through all of this and us realizing our hunger to be among each other. But yesterday morning, we were watching Jensen Franklin. And I love him. He is, he was raised Church of God. And he was raised in North Carolina from a
big family.
Mm-hmm. And he talked about yesterday in his sermon.
His mother's one of 29 or 28, 26. Or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's a large family. Yeah. But he said when they would go to their grandparents' home, he said his grandfather, who was blessed, he was a wealthy man, and he was very blessed. And
had sawmill.
Sawmill and all that.
Had
but
his own
what,
airplane.
What really spoke to me was he said before, and Bill will tell you because our kids made fun of doing this, before they would go like on holidays or wherever, he said before we were allowed to go out in the yard and play football, whatever, he said we had church in the house. He said, and everybody sang and played their guitar, you know.
Yeah, whatever they had, they going to bring it and sing
and
it.
All the 28 brothers and sisters had to get up and speak and say something. Yeah. He said, but my grandfather believed that you don't do anything until you do that first.
Right.
Yeah, if you
and
go,
then you can go in my yard and play football.
Right.
Yeah,
if you're going to eat my food, you're going
to hear the
praise
word first.
The person that provided it.
Yeah,
with
I mean,
God,
it's so awesome. So he talked about the sermons he has been doing is called Miracles in the Home. These last three. Last Sunday, Easter Sunday, was amazing.
Yeah, but I missed
yesterday,
that one.
I was steady taking, just like I'm at church, I got my notebook and my Bible, I'm steady taking notes. And yesterday he talked about how many times in the scriptures, and I wrote it down, that home or house is mentioned in the New Testament. It's 39 times. Okay, and he starts going through just naming some, which I thought was so cool as he was sitting there naming. I was like, oh, that's, yeah, I know about that story. So in Acts 2, he talks about the birthplace of the church in the upper room.
Right.
It was in a man's home. Acts chapter 9, Ananias, he's the one that went to Saul of Tarsus. And they sent him to that address. It was in a home. Cornelius in Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 12, Rhoda's house, where Peter came when he was released from prison. They were in the house praying.
You mentioned Acts, upper room.
Yeah, I did that first. Acts 16, Paul and Silas were in prison, but when they got out,
went to the jailer's house,
and their house was saved. Acts 18 was the Corinthian leader. Acts 20, Paul taught public, it says, and from house to house. Acts 21, Philip, we talked about Philip the evangelist going from house to house. And then this is what I wanted to get the scriptures because I thought this was cool when he said this. Acts 28, it says, Paul had rented a house and for 2 years, it's right here, I'm going to read it because I never thought about that. Acts 28, 30 and 31 says, and Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own hired house. And received all that came unto him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no man forbidding him.
Amen.
He was in his home for 2 years.
Preaching.
Yeah,
they came
the word.
To him,
yeah.
Preaching the word in his home. So he was talking about the importance of home.
Right.
And the miracles begin in your family,
right.
In your home.
Right, right.
And then they also were in the synagogue daily reading the word and worshiping and stuff. So it was both. But the importance of it being in your home cannot be understated.
Well, that's true. I mean, it's, you know, I was telling somebody the other day, I said, you know, the scripture says judgment begins in the house of God. You know, and everybody looks at church buildings as the house of God. But the Bible says that we are the temple.
Yes.
We are the temple.
Yep.
So if judgment begins in the house of God and we are the temple, it should begin in us and then in our homes and then flood out.
you know.
Amen.
And that's why, you know, I love all the little memes and the little things on Facebook mm-hmm. about all these people having to homeschool the kids and saying, now you know what the teachers are going through and y'all want to blame the teachers all the time.
You still thinking it's not your child?
Exactly.
I'd like to give a shout out to Tony Foster.
Oh, yeah.
Good morning, our friends.
Good morning.
Him and his wife sit side by side.
Yes. And I watch him all the time. Brother Tony, you are a blessing. I want you to know that. You and your wife both. And I watch everything that you post on Facebook. You are a blessing.
Absolutely. They're just good people.
Good people. Good people.
Blessed to know them.
And I tell you something else that was powerful that I was reading and studying on yesterday. We're talking about this virus, and you know, a lot of people say, why did God do this, you know? This guy said this, and it just struck a chord with me. You know, he said, just like this virus, everybody thinks that God, you know, makes bad storms come and blow your house down and all that. God, that's not God, you know?
Right.
God, that's not God. He said, if it was God, it would be contradicting when they woke Jesus up in the boat and he came out and said, peace be still. If that's his daddy causing that to happen, and then he's going to rebuke his daddy, you know, that's not, you know, that don't go together. Right. You know what I'm saying? And then flips it around and tells the guys, you know, why y'all wake me up? You know, y'all could have done this yourself.
That's
you
what I was
faith,
fixing to
you
say.
Know?
It's like he was aggravated.
Yeah, he was
like,
mad.
Why didn't y'all just
do
speak
it,
to the
you
storm?
Know, just do it.
Yeah.
And this is what I told my people. Everybody's been saying, well, preacher, you've been preaching a lot on faith. And, you know, how do you have more faith and this and that? I said, first of all, you have faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So you got to know the word.
Yeah.
In order to believe the word.
Mm, really?
I said, but here's the whole thing. With having faith. Having faith is being, the Bible says that now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. You know, faith is when you have no control and you're reaching out, grabbing nothing and holding on to that nothing until it becomes something.
Right.
You know? And a lot of people don't want to do that because, and I hate to say it, but it's that Jezebel spirit that still flows through the church. And I'm not talking about the world. I'm talking about the church.
Yes.
It still flows through the church where they want control.
Come on.
And, you know, as long as I'm in control, I got faith about it.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
Right.
You know, we got $1.2 million in the bank. I'm saying for a church, and our church don't. What I wish you did.
But,
I mean, you got $1.2 million in the bank and you want to build a new building. There's no faith there.
Right.
Because you got the money to do it.
Right.
You know, but when you step out and say, we're going to build a new building and we ain't got but $20,000 in the bank, that's faith that you're going to, you know, stand on.
Absolutely.
And we've done that. We said in the beginning of the year that we were proclaiming and decreeing and declaring that we would break ground on our new sanctuary by the end of the year. We had no clue that all this was going to come about, you know, but 2 weeks ago when in the midst of this stuff, I had a lady drive up in my yard and write a check to the church building fund for $20,000. You know,
see, God, we put limits on
we
him.
Do.
Mm-hmm. And,
we
and
do.
And so, you know, we were talking about this the other day. I said, we need to have, the word tells us that we are saved by the
blood
of the Lamb and the
word of our testimony.
Word of our testimony. Mm-hmm. And what happened to the old testimony services we used to have where people can be encouraged by hearing what God has done? Bill and I, you know, there's two miracles God performed for us at the time when, you know, when all things seemed impossible.
Right.
He put money in our checking account that was hid for months, and we were able to make our house payment when Bill had back surgery.
If I'd have known, that wouldn't have been his.
Right, you see what I'm saying? And I think that's why he hid it.
Yeah.
He protected us from an 18-wheeler killing us. I know that for a fact. That's another testimony that takes a while to tell. And we don't hear of the goodness of God anymore from other people. Mm-mm. Like, and it so encourages you when you can hear people's testimony and you may can encourage someone else with that testimony. And I can't wait through all of this for all the testimonies that are come flooding in of
Amen.
People of how God provided.
Well, I'll tell you, I'm going to probably flip some tables and chairs and pews over when I have church. And I say, because every Wednesday night in my Bible study, the first thing I do is I open up with prayer requests, you know, and I go around the room, and then we pray. And then as soon as we get done praying, I said, okay, now I want some praise reports.
Right. You know? Right.
And I might be got one or two people to say something.
Right.
And I'm like, every person in this room, if you didn't say nothing, but Lord, I thank you for letting me live another day.
Yes.
You
know, I woke up this morning.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Just something, some kind of praise coming out. Praise I'm telling him. You, when we have church back and I ask for praise reports and nobody say anything, I'm going to tell the church slap down.
Right. Let me tell you what I'm so excited about. I told Bill, we watch Perry Stone a lot too. Yeah. I love his prophetic teachings, but he is doing starting May the 11th through the 15th live on Facebook, and months and months and months ago, he stopped through one of his prayer services. We were watching, I pray with him live on Thursday night, and he looked straight into the lens of the camera and he said, I feel this, and I got to say this, there's coming a time shortly, the only way we're going to be able to get the word out and preach through the lens of this camera. Do you hear what I'm saying? I mean, this was months ago.
Yeah, it was a while ago.
Yeah, and so I was like, wow.
Because I'm thinking, well, he already does that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he grabbed the camera. Yeah, he grabbed the camera. And I mean,
we're all going to be doing that.
Yes. Yeah. You know? And so anyway, he is doing, starting May the 11th through the 15th, he is going to do, this is exactly how I put it out there, old time Holy Ghost revival meeting every night online. From 7 to whenever, and Judy Jacobs is going to be doing the music, and her husband, he said, we're going to do some old-time camp meeting
and songs. Yeah.
And it's going to be, and I am so excited. I'm
man.
Like,
man,
I'm looking
forward. Yeah, I got it. Y'all make sure that I get that information so I can get it.
Through the 15th, yeah. I will definitely do that. We'll keep sharing that, because I am so excited about that. I mean, some of them old-time camp meetings where we grew up.
Oh, yeah.
And camp meetings, people's, I mean, lives I love trained. All the worship
songs. I do too.
I love all our music. Yeah. Now, so I'm not doubt. Taking no doubt. Any of that.
Well, you got to get back to the basics.
But there was something about those songs.
Oh man, you break out. Oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face. Uh-huh, you know.
Yeah,
You know. I mean, some good old stuff. Yes, sir.
I am very excited about that. So, and what God's going to be doing, and so we will keep mentioning that Holy Ghost revival. But you got to be following Perry Stone either on his YouTube page or his Facebook page to be able to pretend. I mean, we do it. We sling it up on our TV and watch it.
Yeah.
We have revival right there in our living room. Yesterday morning when we were watching Pastor Jensen at the end, he said, don't you get your family around you? Don't you praying together? Well, our children don't live with us. And I have a big family picture. And I went and got it. And I laid it on my coffee table, and I got on my knees and laid my, and just like they were there with me praying, we were praying. I was praying over my kids and grandkids.
Yeah.
Just like they were physically sitting in that living room with me.
That's good stuff, man.
Rachel says the whole time she's trying to watch the show, it just spins and spins. And I'm thinking she means the little like download symbol. I'm hoping we're not rotating all over the.
I know, right? Well, everybody's
I was wondering why I was getting dizzy.
And so I'm excited about that. But I want to tell y'all something Rachel shared with me yesterday. This is kind of changing the subject, but kind of going back to
it's all
what
Jesus,
we've been,
girl. Go
what
ahead.
We've been going through. Several years ago, Rachel, you can put the date in if you remember it. She sent me the link. We had an It's Really Supernatural show out here, and it was Pastor Walter, Rachel's husband, JFK, and me, and Rachel. And we were talking about the eclipse, you know, the big eclipse everybody was talking about. Right. We were getting planned to go down there and do all this kind of stuff. And Mark Biltz, he wrote a book talking a lot about that kind of stuff, the eclipse, the blood moons, different things like that that go in the sky. But one of the things he was teaching on, which I thought was so amazing that touched me, was talking about cleansing, like that how the eclipse went across the United States. Talk about cleansing across the United States, that this is a sign for the people and stuff like this. And one of the things he said, and I spoke it in the video, Rachel's the one that told me, she said, go to minute 3:15 and you were speaking. And he's talking about, I said, this sign and this cleansing is coming for the lukewarm church and the unrepentant church and the, you know, and I mean, he's saying this kind of stuff, and I was watching it, and this was 3 years ago, about what's coming across the land, and God's not talking to the world, he's talking to his church,
right,
which is what I believe he's talking to now. I believe the world is hearing, but I don't think they have the ears to hear like the body has the ears to hear now, and he's trying to get our attention. And another teaching that I will try to find and put in this link was another one that Perry Stone done talking about what God's doing in the body right now, what he's trying to do and make our robes white and us, we, you know, as a bride is ready for the bridegroom. He talked about, you know, no bride is going to walk down the aisle with a big old coffee stain on her wedding gown.
Right.
That garment is not going to be spotted. And that's what he's doing right now, trying to. Yeah. And he said, because you can walk into church all day long and know how to raise your hands and act right and do all the things, and nobody will ever know those hidden sins of the heart.
Right.
But God knows.
Well, that's true, too. And another thing, too, that I heard a preacher talking the other day, and it really made a lot of sense. He said, you know, the Bible talks about the great revival and all this and that. He said, you know, I don't see why God's not using this and could be using this to prepare the church for revival.
Right.
You know, to prepare for the revival.
I think he is using
this. Because
something's coming.
We just, you know, you think about a regular revival service at your church. You know, most people have them once or twice a year. Mm-hmm. And it has become just a series of services.
Exactly.
You know? I mean, there's no.
Who's going to be speaking?
Right.
Who ain't coming in.
Yeah, exactly. And there's no anticipation. Right. And I'm thinking, you know, I don't know why God just put this in my spirit, but I'm going to say it. When David got thrown out of the temple where he couldn't go, and finally when they told him he could come back, and he said, I was glad when they said unto me, you know, let us go into the house of the Lord. Uh-huh, you know, uh-huh. A lot of preachers use that scripture, but the context of that, David had been kind of kicked out, you
right.
know?
Right.
And so he was now getting the opportunity to go back, and he was all excited.
Yes.
You know, and I'm anticipating that kind of atmosphere for our church.
Yes.
When we able to get back together, and that would be, and I'm not trying to tell God how to do his business, but you know, what a perfect time to break out a mass revival.
Well, I think we declare that and we speak that into the atmosphere. When we're able to be together again, I think things will be different.
Yeah.
I think the problem too, like when we came back to Christ, some of the stuff since I was raised Presbyterian, I never got to experience. So I was looking forward to like a tent meeting and stuff. Well, when I got there, it was, you know, three songs and then preaching.
Just like a regular church service.
Yeah, well, and that kind of, I'm like, well, this ain't
we were so busy with, everybody was so busy with an agenda. And I think that's where the church messed up. Not that they were trying to do anything wrong.
There's nothing wrong with order, but at the same time, you got, if God's got it.
Somewhere in your bulletin, somewhere in your order, you got to have a space for God.
Right. Well, it needs to say Holy Ghost. Spirit.
Right. Yeah. So, I remember years ago, I was pastoring in an organization, and the district, I don't remember what they called them back then, but anyway, this the district leader, they were having a district service at my church. And he came up to me and he said, Pastor, this is going to be the order of service. At 7 o'clock, we'll start, you know, at 7:05. Y'all can start worship at 7:15. I said, you give me 10 minutes to do worship. And he was like, yeah. And he going through. So he went through his whole little list. And I said, well, brother, I really respect your list. I said, but you ain't got a spot anywhere in here for God, for his move and all that. Oh, well, you know, if the Lord. I said to myself, this
Lord ain't coming.
This cuz in my church, you know. And I said, he ain't going to dictate to me what I can do.
Right.
We sang 30 minutes. I ain't stopped. And I'm telling you, the Spirit of God fell.
Right.
You know?
That's the key.
I think God's agenda is different from ours.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, there is a place for order. But I do believe that there's also a place for, if you don't have the freedom to let the Holy Ghost move and to move in people's life. I mean, you know.
See, like you said, it's great to have order, you know. But for years and years and years, we have positioned ourselves, especially on a Sunday morning, okay? We have positioned ourselves that we've got to try to be out of there by 12 o'clock because the people get antsy at 12 o'clock. I don't know whoever came up with that 12 o'clock hour, but they've came up with it. And we have burnt that into our minds, and we either rush or whatever. But, you know, I think about the night or the day in the upper room. You know, when they were just there, you know,
all in one mind.
Right. It wasn't just a hour of church meeting.
They were unified.
They were there for a while.
I hear what you're saying, but at the same time,
you can't draw it out if there's nothing happening.
Right, exactly. You got to know.
Right.
Right, you got to know.
That's
right.
The key. You've got some pastors that'll draw it out.
Yeah, just trying to make something happening. Up. Right.
You know, God's not going, you know, I mean, come on.
Growing up, my grandfather, he was a preacher, and he used to say, well, I'm going to tell you what. I'd rather have wildfire than no fire. Right. Right. I said, yeah, I understand that, Granddaddy, but I want it to be Jesus, you know?
Right. Because especially, right. Especially nowadays with all the technology and, you know, a lot of services are on a time limit.
Yeah.
Especially TV services.
Right, they, right, right.
Yeah, you got to be done an hour. But see, I have no problem tuning into a live preaching and there's no preaching.
Oh, yeah.
If they start worshiping and the spirit starts moving then they fade out and say, thank you for watching our service.
Well, I'm going to say this
I don't have
too.
A problem with that.
I'm going to say this too. Me and my wife were talking about it the other day and I wasn't trying to be, and I know it's going to sound kind of braggadocious maybe, but my wife, I told her, I said, I got my sermon. I said, it's short and sweet, you know? And she said, as long as it's anointed,
right,
you know, it don't really matter. And I said, well, the anointing comes from the anointed, you know. And I said, if you are anointed, and I think about Jensen Franklin, because Jensen was on a time limit,
right?
You know, even when we went to the marriage conference, you could tell that he has programmed their whole service to work, but it's anointed service.
But I think it's because he's heard from God before.
Right.
It's not, you know.
Everything is anointed, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, even though there's a 30-minute time limit or a 45, whatever the time limit, I don't remember what it is. But, you know, they have, their praise team has prayed and practiced.
Right.
And they're in that sink. And then when he comes in.
I have seen him just sit back down.
Yeah.
Right. No, we're going to sit back down. Yeah. Go ahead. I'll keep on.
Yeah. I mean, it's just.
So,
the freedom is there. And I believe that.
He's not going to shut the Holy Spirit.
Yeah,
though.
He would. Yeah, it would just keep going and flowing as it does.
That's why I'm always impressed. I say impressed. I don't know.
It's
impressive to, you know, I've talked to pastors and they know what they're preaching the next 4 weeks. You know.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that. You know. Especially if you're doing a series,
right?
You know, which I've never been a series type preacher. I'm one of these dudes that I want fresh stuff.
But here's the thing, because even our pastor will say that. He said, I'm going to preach a series on this, but you don't know what that's. I mean, it could be anything from A to Z.
Right.
I mean, it's you know, where he's taking you.
Right.
Just sometimes you're sitting there going, you know, with your mouth open. Mm-hmm. So I think as long as you. If God tells you to do a series on how to make your home great,
right,
and you're doing what God tells you to
do, you own it.
You own it. So
well, you got to look at the personality too. If you're going to a church where the pastor is a teaching individual,
right,
his sermon is going to be longer because he wants you to get everything.
Right.
Or if you go to an evangelist, they're going to be quick and to the point because they want you up here at the altar, you know, accepting Jesus.
Yeah.
You know,
spend time. Yeah.
Right. You've got to pick where you're comfortable at, because there's tons of choices out there.
Well, it's like my father-in-law. He's always, from, you know, me being around, he's done a lot of series of messages, you know, on whatever, you know, and it just amazes me. You know what I'm saying? I'm mesmerized by it because, you know, I mean, he studied all week long and you know, he gets a piece like, you know, like Jensen, he gets a piece at a time as God downloads it, you know, and I told my wife, I said, I don't know if it's because, you know, I got a touch of something called ADD or ADHD, but I'm one of these guys that, you know, I study all week long, but most of the time it's late Saturday night or early Sunday morning before I feel like I got the word, you know?
You know, our pastor's come to the pulpit before and he said, you know, I've studied all week and I was going to preach you this, but before I walked up on stage, God said, no, you're going to do this.
Exactly, I've done
and
it.
And I immediately changed to what he, you know, to what
he said. I'll never forget a few Sundays before all the stuff started, but that particular Sunday, I didn't have to play. And one of my praise leader, Joey, he's learning to play the keyboard. So he was actually up there playing the keyboard and I'm ready. You know, I'm in the worship, you know, not often do I get to just stand there, you know, in worship and I'm there and God says, you know, this ain't what you're going to preach. You're going to preach this, this, and this. And I'm like, really? And I'm grabbing my Bible and I'm flipping or either I'm on my
I ain't read
pad.
That yet.
Yeah. I'm on my pad trying to go. And I could you know, I knew the set list. Right. And I knew they were coming to a close, you know, with that And I looked at him and go,
yeah, but the spirit ain't moving.
Yes, it is.
But see, I believe just like that, when God changes your message like that,
mm-hmm.
I believe even if you hadn't have opened your Bible when you stood up there in the pulpit, it would have came. He would have downloaded what you needed.
Oh, he did. I mean, all the only thing I needed was the scripture.
Uh-huh. Right.
And you know how sometimes, you know, we've all read the Bible and we, you know, but sometimes you just go brain dead.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
You know, and I'm over there trying to search, thinking of some words that's in the scripture to try to find the scripture quick, you know, and I'm over there searching, you know, and it wasn't, you know, I don't know if I wasn't connecting to the internet, but I was having some problems. So I just kept telling him, do it, sing it again.
You know, it's funny like that when you think of stuff, because like I can say, you know, I know in the book of John, so-and-so, well, where's that? I don't, if I had my Bible, I could go straight to it because I can see it on the page,
right.
On this column,
right,
on this side, mm-hmm. circle, you know, whatever, mm-hmm. stuff like that.
Well, I'll tell you, funny thing, when we first got back into Christ, I've always gone to like two churches.
Right.
And for about 3 weeks, each church was preaching on the same thing.
Yeah.
I was a new Christian.
Yeah.
You know, so I went to my pastor and I said, y'all go to a web page? And he said, for what? And I said, for your sermons.
He started
laughing. He's like, no, brother, that's God talking. Evidently,
yeah.
You need to
right.
hear.
Whatever
said,
it
okay.
is.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, because I didn't know.
I'll tell you something else.
I just assumed, you know.
It's funny. I see funny. I don't want to say funny. It's a lot of times when I get done preaching and I get in the car or whatever, I look at my wife and I'm like, that was horrible. That was just plumb horrible. Mm-hmm. You know, it didn't come out like I wanted it to.
It was horrible for somebody, though.
You know, it was just, you know, my wife's like, no. And you can always tell when somebody's going to try to lie, you know.
Well, not lie.
They're trying to make you feel good, but they're lying. Their voice ever goes up, like if you ask Bill and say, baby, does this look good? And he'll go, yeah. You know, he's lying.
No, because you know what?
I don't do that.
He don't do that. He'd go, you need to take that off.
Yeah,
that
don't look good.
Does that make you look fat? No, your fat makes you look fat.
That's me, Bill. I'm the same way. But anyway, my wife was like, if I said, baby, that message is horrible, she'll go, no. If she ever goes up on that voice, I'm like, huh? You know, but if she's like, no, it was really good, you know, this or that and third. But those times that you feel that way, it's amazing, because I'll get a text or I'll get a message saying, pastor, that word really hit. Yesterday, y'all, we did that song Holy Water,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. and we practiced it Saturday night, and I'm telling you, it was slamming. When I tell you, my wife came in and did the woman part, and
uh-huh.
It was just awesome. We got there yesterday morning to do it, because we sped up our service a little bit yesterday. We started at 10 instead of 10:30, uh-huh. trying to beat the rain. And we got up there, and we didn't run over it yesterday morning. And it was like, you know, different ones forgot what we were supposed to be doing. You wouldn't have been able to tell it.
Right.
Right.
Because we're playing, you know, me and Clint, I look over at Clint and I could just see disgust on him. And right. I don't want to say disgust. That ain't the right word. But he's disappointed.
Irritation.
You know? Yeah. Well, right. I think he was disappointed because me and him both were expecting this to be fire, you
right.
know?
Right.
And, anyway, I'm playing the piano, he's playing the guitar, and I'm looking over at him, and I'm feeling it. I know he's feeling it, and we go to the next song, and then we go to the next song, and I just couldn't get it. You know, it was good stuff. Even we did Waymaker,
uh-huh.
you know, and I was like, I ain't feeling it. You know, that one song threw me out,
devil.
You know, the devil, you
devil.
Know.
Uh-huh.
And so I was like, finally, it was about time for me to preach. I said, you know, I got to shake this, you know, uh-huh. I got to shake it. So I, you know, was preaching, and I brought it up in my sermon.
Right.
I said, this is how the devil likes to work.
Yes.
Your faith into your fears and all this and that. I said, you know, we practiced this song last night. It was on fire. I said, we get up here this morning. It's like, everybody forgot what we did, you know?
Yeah.
And I said, it just threw me for a loop. But I knew I had to shake myself to get out of it. And, you know, but man, we had comment after comment about how good it was and this and that and the third. And that's why I was telling my wife, I said, the things that I'm trying to overcome in my life is, don't worry about what you think.
Mm,
because it's not about what you think.
Mm-hmm.
Worry about, or don't worry about anything. You just let God take because regardless, and I told my church this, is that regardless, whatever it sounded like to us, it was still a praise offering to him.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah.
And so when you're
offering up,
we're offering up praise, you know, a sacrifice of praise, he's just like,
right.
You know, and we're like, oh,
he's
man,
there inhabiting
more.
His praise.
Exactly.
It's like I tell Bill, and I wrote this in my notebook. I say this all the time. Smith Wigglesworth, I read a lot of his stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that man had great faith. And he asked one time, you know, how can you walk in this kind of faith when you don't see people immediately healed or whatever? And this was his response. And I say it all the time. He says, I'm not moved by what I see.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not moved by what I feel.
Mm-hmm.
I'm only moved by what I believe.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And I said, now that is a mouthful there because,
Lord, that's powerful.
Because we're so quick to go on the way we feel or what we see, you know?
I'm telling you. And it's so aggravating too because, you know, we're so emotional. We're emotional people.
Instead of saying, you know, because you're a musician or whatever, mm-hmm. and y'all are up there and y'all know if things are going wrong or whatever, but the people out
they
there,
had a clue.
The word says he inhabits the praise of his people. People were praising
him. Oh, they were.
And so there's the truth.
But my thing is, and what I'm trying to overcome is that I don't want, because I'm real bad about facial expressions.
Yeah, my,
you know, too. I mean, I can't hide a lot of things sometimes, you know, right. If something sounds horrible or something's off, my face will show it, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And that's what we were picking with Skylar the other day, was singing, if you're happy and you know it, say amen.
Yeah.
You know, or so like that.
Hands.
And then I was picking out, I said, if you're grumpy and you know it, your face will surely show it, you know? It, because, I mean, sometimes in our life, we can't, our facial expressions, you know?
And, well, see, I'm very passionate over praise and worship music.
Mm-hmm.
It's just because I love music.
Me too.
And it will ruin, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Because in my mind, if you're up there doing it for God, you should do it the best you can. Now, that doesn't mean you have the best voice in the world. It
right.
don't mean you have the best, you know, musical ability. It just means you're up there doing the best you can. And when I see someone up there just going through the motions, and you can tell.
Oh, yeah.
That bothers me, you know, but if you go up there and y'all are trying and you say, you can actually see that, well, you can tell they practiced the song, you know,
right.
It touches people because they can tell it.
Right.
You know?
So I want to share something with y'all this morning. All right. I brought it and I wasn't sure if there was going to be a spot to do it, but I think now's probably a good time to share it. January 12th of this year, Pastor Sandra Kennedy gave a word to her church. And one of the things that has stood out to me through all of this was one paragraph in these several pages of what she wrote. And talking about what God is doing in the church in this hour, during this pandemic and everybody. It says, and I'm going to read it because I want y'all to hear this. Morning Manna people, listen to this. It says, the favor I'm releasing on my remnant, and that's capitalized, in this hour will come to you from outside the walls of the church.
That's good.
For the world to see my presence, capitalized, in you, and they will quake. So, and that's not all of it. But so right now with this pandemic going on, what is the world seeing in the bride? I mean, what are they seeing? Are they seeing peace
or fear
and trust? Or are they seeing fear or whatever? It says the day is coming soon. That when the world has no answers and the people are paralyzed with fear, I will give the answer through my remnant church.
Mm.
From the house of my presence, men and women will hear me as Daniel heard and as Joseph heard, and provide the wisdom the world cannot find anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So he is doing a work in us.
Amen.
So that he can prepare us for what eventually I believe is going to come on the world.
Yeah.
And we're going to have to know how to speak and stand and be strong. And I think right now, I love the fact that she said my remnant church. And it takes me back to that prophetic thing, speaking, not the lukewarm church, not the church that's compromising, not the church that's the remnant church that is doing what they're supposed to be doing.
But, and I'm hoping pastors will preach on that once we get back in the church, because as a Christian, I've seen a lot of non-Christian stuff coming from Christians.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, you've got Christians that are just paralyzed by fear. They're not doing anything to help the fellow man out. And you've got other Christians that are doing a lot of stuff, but they're taking pictures of it and posting it on Facebook, bragging on it, which takes the blessing completely away.
Right. Well, God says, and if you get, you got your applaud, you got it right there. That's your reward.
Right.
And I hope, I mean, because to me, all of this has been a test. Now, conspiracy theorists would think, you know, it's a test by the government or whoever, but I'm looking at it as a test from God also, because he's looking to see who's going to stand up. Who's going to actually do?
Who's going to be his hands and feet?
Right. Who's actually going? You know, because we do a lot of stuff that we don't tell anybody about, because it's, you know, it's between us and God.
That's right.
You know?
Right.
And that's just something as simple as just building somebody up. Hey, don't worry about your job. You're going to be fine. You've got, if you need toilet paper, come to the house. I'll give you one sheet.
And God's blessing is, this is the way I look at it. You want God to bless you financially? This is just a kingdom principle. It's not, you know, me.
Bless him financially.
Bless him, but not just bless him, but others. It's like, I'm going to bless you out of my need. Like, I, you know, there's somebody that lost their home that needed something more. I'm still got a home.
Right. Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Right. I'm going to trust God to provide. Mm-hmm. If I give money to that situation, God's not going to fail me. Right. I mean,
exactly.
That's the way that the kingdom works.
We took up a bunch of stuff and took it down to Nicksville area.
I didn't see it on Facebook.
You know? It's on there.
Yeah,
they took the picture was they took the picture of the stuff we had in the church, and we were thanking our people for bringing. Right. I mean, it was a massive amount of stuff. But they did not, you know, they didn't do anything else after that. We didn't go down there.
We didn't go down there
and do all that kind of stuff.
It's, it's kind of like, but here's a selfie and here's $100.
Right.
Whatever.
That's crazy. But you're exactly right. But we, you know, that's what God has called us to do, to be his hands and his feet, you know, to be there for our people and his people. You know, we're all kingdom people, you know, it don't matter.
And to make sure we reiterate that, if I give Sean's church $100 and he tells me, we're going to take, you know, barbecue to such and such, I would like to see a picture of that.
See where your money went.
But I don't want to see Sean, you know,
with the barbecue sandwich handing
it to him. Right. You know, saying, I did this.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Well, you know, Sean, I had a dream, and we're going to do a show on this, me and April, soon, about dreams. But in one of the dreams I had, and I wrote it down specifically, in the dream I was concentrating on helping people, no lie, but in the dream I could only help their hands or their feet.
Mm.
I wasn't able, like, it was specifically to those two areas of the body, which the Lord spoke, and I wrote out a whole bunch of stuff on. I mean, just some exciting stuff coming up. So I do want to let our watchers know that are watching us. April and I want to do a program on dreams.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
And interpretation of dreams and visions. You can be here, but I'm just saying.
It's going to be under Your Morning Manna or something y'all coming up with.
We don't know yet.
Okay. Because you had to ask permission.
Oh, whatever. I ain't
going to
ask you nothing. Exactly. But anyway, I'm excited about that. I'm just excited in general about what God's doing.
I am too. I mean, a lot of people, like you said, are running scared or fear or whatever. And you know, I see nothing but God's fingerprints.
You know, and when you know, some people say this and don't mean it, but when I say it, I mean it with every bit of me. You know, they're like, "Aren't you worried about catching that?" Well, you know, if I catch it, and the worst thing that happened to me is I die and I get to see the face of Jesus.
Yeah, you're the winner either way.
How's that going to bother me? Am I going to miss my wife and kids? No, because I'm looking at Jesus.
That's right.
Listen, you know?
Will they miss you? No, because they didn't like you anyway.
Right. I'm going to wake up dead. I'm going to be happy. You know?
So. It's in the words of Paul, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain.
Yeah. Right.
And when you look at it that way, it's a whole different meaning. And I'm going to tell you something too. Back in February of this year, our pastor was preaching a sermon, and in the middle of the sermon, he started talking about God gave a word, and he says, "I want you to keep your eyes on New York. Watch New York. Watch what I do." Because he's telling church, don't miss the sign. Do not miss what God's trying to do right now.
Mm-hmm.
And if I was a part of New York, I would get out of it simply because what their governor said. I'd leave New York.
Yeah, so it's a lot of things. So I encourage you to go back. I'm going to try to see if I can get Rachel, if you're still watching. She can find all these things and put them in the link. But yesterday, he was preaching again about the things, you know, in New York and what's going on. He says, and you wonder why I watch New York. God told me to watch New York. and see what's going on. Have y'all listened to what that governor has been saying of New York?
And now he went against all of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he didn't just single out God. He also he shot Allah in there. He shot Buddha and everything. Nobody did.
We did.
We did this ourselves.
And they didn't. What amazes me, he didn't learn the lesson that the other governor learned. I mean, that went through with 9/11. You know, you can't proclaim yourself as higher than God and get away with it. God's going to take you down. So
yeah.
Well, that's the, you know, I'm not a prophetic, you know, speaker, but I'm going to say this. He shot himself with that one.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
He going to be shown who God is.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's reminds me of, you know, the scripture, the fella falling out the window, you know,
right.
You don't talk about the man, you know what I'm saying? You don't talk about the man. You know?
I think there are so many different aspects of what's going on right now with this coronavirus and everything, from what God's doing to us in the body of Christ, how he is refining us and taking us through the fire. And purifying us.
That's
to get rid of the
scriptures I read
things.
Yesterday. Yep.
You know, God,
First
I believe
Peter.
He's doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I believe he is prophetically speaking to those who have denied him, who are continuing to murder babies by the millions, who are, you know, there's
millions
just so much
millions.
Going on through all of this that I think, you know, we need to kind of take a step back and look and see, you know, we know the enemy meant this to be bad. God meant it. He's going to use it for his good. And the church is going to come out stronger. And I heard this. I was listening to a worship set yesterday morning about 5 a.m. And I was listening. And during the speaking in one of the worship sets, one of the men said, and I thought it was so great, he said that the church is not being quarantined. The church is being incubated right
Absolutely.
Now.
Amen.
And I thought that was so, I wrote it down. I thought, you are so right. You know, it's all in your perspective. Like, I have to stay home today, or praise God, I get to stay home in a home that God's provided with
me
today.
Right.
And he says, so during this, when the world's speaking quarantine, the body of Christ is incubated. We all know what an incubator does.
Right.
From a baby that was born too premature to can't survive outside at quite yet, to a little baby chicken that's in the heat lamps and all to be raised. There's such a meaning to that.
Right.
So right now, during this incubation period, let God do his work. Let him refine us and purify us and bring us to a place where, you know, the things that are going to come, we're going to be ready.
You know, because everybody knows, if they've been watching anything or talk to me, my passion is getting rid of abortion. I don't, and I wish I could be more passionate about, you know, what's happening with this virus. But until we stop the senseless killing of unborn, I don't think, I'm not concerned with that. You know, when you come to me with 40,000 died, you know, because of this. When I share 12 million died through abortion.
Every time I see that, when you post that, well, it breaks my heart. Yeah. You know, I mean,
and you know, people's like, you do that every Sunday, I do it when God
tells
touches
you
me.
Right.
You know,
well, I tell you, in what you were saying there, I heard a pastor say, you know, that the church was not, you know, out like that. They were being deployed. You know,
that's
this is war.
Yeah,
right.
You know, we're being deployed.
Yeah.
You know, everybody thinks that we're still set up in a church building. That's not the purpose.
Right.
The purpose of the church building is to get you refueled,
give you knowledge, to go out and
do what you called to do. Right.
But see, right now during this time, we're spending more time with the Lord so that we're equipped to go out into this world. When you've got people standing in line, and I see it all day long where my part time job. The ugliness coming out of people's hearts, the words they're spewing, the stuff, and the whole time I'm standing there praying under my breath, and I'm thinking.
Well, when this first started, I told her, I said, look, you can do what you want to do, but when I go out in amongst all this, I'm going to try my best to smile and be totally different than what I normally am.
Yeah.
I was looking at it as an opportunity to show people, you know. And yesterday, I was in Food Line getting some stuff for supper. And she said,
can you give me just a minute so I can sterilize everything? I said, take your time. Mm-hmm. You know, you're doing something to protect me. Yeah. So, of course, take your time. Mm-hmm. She's like, thank you. You'd be surprised. And I said, no, I wouldn't.
No.
You know.
It's just been, you truly see, I've never seen the scripture more
alive and coming
alive. Yeah. Coming alive there. Before my eyes, and it says, what is in the heart comes out of the mouth. Because, man, wow. I ask the Lord to check me every day to place that guard over my mouth. And if there's something in my heart that, that really, cleanse even if I want to say it, take it out. Lord, take cleanse out. Me. I don't want that spot to That's be right. there, which is what exactly. I think he's trying to do because, to everybody.
And I know for me, and I know it had to be for y'all, because when that starts boiling up, I just don't feel good.
Yes. Right, you know, right.
It makes me,
and it's funny too. I mean, I'm a jokester. I love to joke and have fun. And me and Skylar and Missy was in Walmart. I don't know, last week sometime, we were going down the craft aisle because Skylar wanted to get some crafts to do at house, you know. And there was this lady that was looking there too, and I told Skylar, I said, Skylar, you know, stay your 6 foot distance. I said, because you know you've been coughing and having that fever, and I don't want you. And Skylar turned around and looked at me like, shut up, Dad. I ain't had no and that lady kind of looked, you know, I'll go by somebody and start coughing. You know,
listen, it's funny. I wrote that down here so I wouldn't forget.
Yeah.
Do you see that word right there, sneezing?
Yeah.
We have laughed because at work, we've had to try to just make so light out of it.
Well, you got to.
And, you know, with allergies going on and we live in the South and that kind of stuff. And now at work, everybody that works with us, like if you sneeze, what do they say? Get away from me, Rona. Get away. Don't come, you know.
Yeah. Is that you, Rona?
And we have to laugh at it because, I mean, I know it's serious. I don't mean laughing at the disease, you know, but you have to just kind of make, you know.
Yeah, you have
and
to.
And I said the quickest way to get rid of an irritating person now, though, is go,
yeah, exactly.
I haven't felt good for a couple of days.
Feel, just my face. Could you feel my forehead? Yeah.
I think I have a fever.
No, I cannot. Come on.
I always like that. I'll get around a bunch of people and say, you know, this cough has got worse since I got back from China.
My chest is killing me.
Yeah, and it's all serious, guys. We are not, I mean, we're just trying to make light of a serious situation and what's going on.
Well, so I'm
going to
laugh. I'm going to laugh because it has definitely changed since I become a Christian because I used to be definitely afraid of hospitals and funeral. You know, I didn't want to die. I didn't, you know, I ain't want to go in no hospital because to me that was dying. Because you know, and now, you know, I'm gonna make a joke about it.
See, I used to work in a funeral home.
Right.
Yeah, and so you know, you had to learn to
laugh,
cope.
Yeah.
You know, and laughter is a good medicine.
Yes,
you
it
know?
Is. Yes, it is.
So you'd have to learn to, you know, take your mind somewhere else.
Because nobody gets out of here alive.
Exactly. And it's, you know, it's a, like Dana said, you know, this is a very serious situation. Mm-hmm. And we're not trying to make light of the situation. But sometimes in your life, you have to laugh about things.
Oh, absolutely.
It's like, well, we went to Columbia a few weekends ago to go to the grocery store up there. And we stopped by this gas station. And this old guy drives up in his old truck, and he's got a mask on, and he's got these gloves on, these surgical gloves that I don't think he's got quite on right, because one of the little fingers was just dangling over there.
He might
have
been missing one.
No, he looked like he had two in one hole. But anyway, he gets out with his cane, and you could tell, you know, you could look at somebody and say, that dude right there is a nasty attitude dude.
Uh-huh.
You know? But he goes up to the door, and he flips the cane over and uses the hook.
Oh, that was smart.
To open the door. But then he grabs the cane handle again that he just touched the door with.
Right.
What was the purpose of that?
Well, it don't live on hardwood.
Listen, it is so funny to watch some things, especially about people and the way they do gloves and all the different things. I'm like, come on.
I like
on.
It when
and
they then, pull the mask down, pull the glove off with the mouth because they're so
then he goes inside, y'all, and buys a pack of cigarettes.
Oh, well, see, he's health conscious.
So you're not worried about cancer, but the Rona going to get you.
Well, that's why he worried about Rona, because he's been smoking for 62 years.
It's just funny, it's man. Just I just crazy. Can't help but laugh,
I'm
man.
I'm telling you.
A comedian I saw, he said, y'all worry about buying Lysol and all that stuff. Y'all don't even know how to use the spray can. Spray it in your eye.
That's so crazy, but I don't know. We just, it's crazy times we're living in right now. And definitely. I think we need to keep our our ears towards heaven. What are you laughing at?
Terry Linda says, are you asked, do you smell that? Because I can't smell.
Yeah, they say taste or smell is one of the things. Yeah. Now, listen, Bill just had it. I mean, we've got a cousin who just, I mean, she had it. And she's just now Sandy. Getting out of the hospital.
Cousin from Virginia. And she had surgery and pneumonia. And then her husband had the flu.
It was
and then
a lot
corona.
Of other things,
and that was,
right.
And she caught it. And they put her on a ventilator. And she's off of it now in a regular room. And I don't mean to call her out on her age or anything. But, I mean, she's more than likely over 70. So, I'm thinking it's all good. Oh, okay.
I mean,
with a mask on a bridge.
On a bridge. We were pulling out the other day, and I'd gone to get some food, and we were pulling, this woman come by, and she was in the turn lane. She was in her own car by herself with a mask on.
Yeah.
And I'm like.
And my cousin that's having issues right now, he posted a meme. And that's what I call it, y'all. So forgive me. But he posted one that said, if you wear a mask in the car by yourself, when all this is over, just stay in your house.
don't come out. Don't come back out.
I mean, you're on a. I see people like, you're out in your yard.
If you're outside.
Walking in our neighborhood and they got masks on. Yeah.
I don't understand.
You're doing it because of allergies.
Right.
Cool.
Right.
You know, whatever.
But put that on.
Put on there. This
so we don't talk about it.
Because I got somebody that does the same thing, man. I get their little video every day, and they're out walking, and they got the N95 mask on, and I'm like, I don't see nobody around you, cuz
you were outside.
You know, you by yourself.
By yourself.
Yeah, it's funny.
But maybe it's allergies. But I'm like you. Clarify that if you're wearing it because of allergies. Don't let us think you out there with a mask because of the corona.
Put an A on your mask.
My wife picks at me because sometimes I don't say corona.
Corona.
I'll say coronas.
Corona.
You got the coronas virus.
Wait, I didn't realize the coronavirus and the COVID-19 is different. I thought it was the same.
I did too. It's not.
It's different, evidently. Because they broke it down the other day on Facebook. I was like, I thought that was the same. COVID-19 is got a little corona in it, but it's different.
Yeah, like you're talking about a mixed drink or something over there with a little corona in it.
Is there a lime?
I do have a question. Maybe y'all can. And I know this is not religious, but maybe y'all can answer this for me.
I'm sure I can.
I know you can. I have noticed around our area, at least, there's not any Chinese restaurants open.
Right. But now you could say it's because people are not going to Chinese restaurant or. I think they're doing it for self-preservation.
Okay.
Because when this first came about, my first thing I told Dan, I'm gonna go get some Chinese tonight.
We sure did. We went and got us some Chinese.
I did it to let our local Chinese restaurant know I ain't worried about it.
Yeah.
Unless y'all been to China recently, but they've got some Mexican people cooking for them. And,
right. Right. And they probably don't have English fresh girl. Bat there.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I think they're doing it just to let people get over it, because they don't want to throw it in the face.
Right.
Because you've got some people in situations like that will throw it in your face.
Yeah.
But if you look at the history of Chinese in this country, they've had it pretty rough.
Yeah.
And I think throughout history, they've just determined it's better just to
back out.
Yeah. Just, back up. And now Ming Ming's and off of 421, I think it's still open and rocking. So and if you're a brand new Chinese restaurant, I would go ahead and shut down. But if you've been established and all, it's no different. They might they
wonder
don't
if the Red Bull still open here naked.
I don't know because
I like that sushi. But I had another question then, since we're on this subject. Maybe you can help me. What was the big deal about all the toilet paper being taken out because of the Rona?
I like to think I started that, but from what I understand, because I work in the paper industry, and from what we've gathered through information and just taking surveys and all, they were afraid primarily for getting quarantined for months. And that was one of their fears of running
not
out
having
of
the toilet paper.
Which
makes sense.
It goes back to like control.
Mm-hmm.
They could control that. So they wanted to have,
right.
if they lost power, if they lost internet, if they lost everything, at least they still had the toilet paper.
Right.
Which is a comfort to some people, I guess. But well, that was the least of my worries. I was looking for chicken.
Bill said, you know, you ain't gonna need no toilet paper, you ain't got no food.
Yeah, right. Go get something to eat. I need some ramen noodles. I need some chicken. I need some beef. Cause I was stressing out over hamburger meat.
Yeah, it was
gone.
You know, I'm not really stressing, but hey, if y'all get some hamburger meat and grab some, you know,
Bill was wanting some spaghetti.
Yeah, spaghetti tacos or sloppy joes. You know, I need my hamburger meat.
I like hamburger meat too.
Yeah. But once I started looking around though and realized, you know, the big box stores might not have had hamburger, but all the local butcher shops.
Right.
And we're blessed with some good butcher shops.
Yeah.
So going back to this whole mask, gloves, hand sanitizer type thing, have you noticed how quickly though everybody flocked to, like, it was toilet paper and hand sanitizer and alcohol and Lysol spray.
Bleach
and disinfectant wipes. Makes me wonder, did these people not use any of this stuff before the virus came along?
None.
Because I told Bill, I said, well, we have some disinfectant wipes and we have Clorox and we have, you know, I'm sitting there thinking.
I mean, what you disinfecting if it's just you in the house?
I washed my hands with soap before all this.
Yeah.
Because we
always buy soap because we wash our hands with it.
And I've always done, like, I'm concerned about cross-contamination and
so
all
that. You know, I work in a very large store and I watch people. I mean, we watch them and they come in, you know, and they, you know, we tell them we sanitize these carts and we do. That's one thing I'll have to give them. We spray the whole cart down. They dry and they, you know, anyway, but they come in, they put their gloves on, they go grab their groceries. Then you can watch them take their glove off and they'll do, you know, dig or whatever. And then they'll put the same glove back on and take the mask down when they're standing there talking to people. And I'm thinking, that's the time you need to have it on. You know, and so, I mean,
well,
it's just
they've never been trained to use PPE.
Right.
You know, you've got people that have never seen a mask.
I'll be honest.
They have them on upside down.
I'll be honest. My daughter over here, she was our saving grace when it came to the sanitizer, because she loves, when we go to Bath and Body Works, to buy Bath and Body Works sanitizer. Yeah, so she had must be 20 or 30 of them things. And me and her mama we're going to have to replenish them when all this is said and done.
Well, you know, we keep a bottle in each one of our vehicles.
Yeah,
we've always done that just because you never know what you
The gas pump. I mean, the gas pump's got to be nice.
And so we did put some gloves in our cars for, like, when we go to pump gas.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that, just to intake. But here's the thing. People are putting the gloves on, touching the gas pump, then getting their wallet stuff, and then opening their car door with those same gloves on. And
I might build a funny one. Was when a guy he didn't have plastic gloves on, but he had, like, isotoners or whatever.
Yeah.
And he goes, bites it, pulls it out, and he's doing what he needs to do, and he's got the glove in his mouth. I'm like, okay, yeah, that's
well, he didn't touch the Rona with that finger right there.
Oh, yeah.
But it's just funny. And I guess maybe because, and you see a lot of the nurses and people that have worked in the medical field laugh about this. Obviously, you've never had to work in a sterile
environment
where you don't cross contaminate stuff. I mean, it's just.
And I think country folk, or southern people, I should say, they having a easier go at it, because I know I licked pretty much everything when I was little.
Yeah.
You know, our grandkids I know have licked some stuff that, oh, they're gonna die. You know, anybody that's ate mud pies, you know, because I had three sisters, so I ate some mud pies.
I drunk bleach one time.
I did too. I thought my sister made me some water.
I thought my mom had me.
And I took a big old swig.
Me too. I had a little glass about that big. I drunk the whole glass.
Yep. I'm right there with you. I did the same thing.
I've been washed. Me and Bill's been washed.
Because Mama told
Linda. Not only by the blood, but the bleach, by the Clorox.
Mama told Linda, make your brother some water, a glass of water. So I waited a little bit, walked in the kitchen, and there was a glass of clear liquid on the washing machine. So I chugged it, and it was bleach.
Y'all stupid. I'm sorry. I'm just saying.
And what's bad, my grandmother and grandfather was in town. My grandfather said, here, chew on this. Just chew it up and swallow it. It was some charcoal. And that's what I did. And then I went around smiling at people. I had black teeth.
I think my mom made me drink milk.
milk. I got charcoal.
I drank milk. Oh, you know, goodness. But I didn't go to the hospital or the doctor.
I didn't either.
You know, I was good.
Okay, so we have had all these kind of discussions. We've been from everywhere.
Oh, it's been good.
It's been good. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think we've helped a lot of people.
Yeah, yeah, giving them our opinion.
Joy. Joy, what we're doing joy. Today.
Okay, so.
Oh, here's a, let me give this tidbit out. Okay. Little doggy bags are good for pumps. 3 rolls for $1 for a little, I'm assuming the doggy poop bags.
Yeah.
Just put your hand in it and grab the pump, you know.
And then so, you can throw it right away.
Throw it right
where away. Where do you purchase doggy poop bags at?
At the like Petco, and I think all the grocery stores have them in the dog section.
Yeah, I think the grocery stores have them poop and all bag. That stuff. We're going to do our word of the day, and we're going to do a this or that. But just because, you remember your this or that bill
yeah,
this morning?
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to do that real quick and give y'all that are watching on Facebook, I want y'all to join in on this one, okay? Because this
one's
pretty cool.
Let's do History Mysteries too real quick, back to back. Yeah.
Okay, we'll do this or that, then History's Mysteries. Here we go.
Summer or winter, Facebook or Twitter, steak or chicken wings, it could be so many things. Right here on this or that with the crew, what will you choose? What will you choose today?
All right, this or that's got Bill beside it, and Terry said Dollar Tree.
Okay.
This or that. Now, I'm famous for this
because
I feel this is the way it should be, because I do to people what I like being done to me.
Mm-hmm.
All right, when you call somebody and their voicemail comes on, do you leave a message or just hang up? I'll go ahead and answer first. I hang up because I look at it. They can look at the phone and see that I called, and they'll call me back. And to me, it's a, I got to go check my messages and do all that. So I kind of help them out by not leaving a message. Mm-hmm. Unless I have something, well, no, I just don't leave a message. So
So you always hang up. You never leave a message.
I just hang up. They'll call me back.
And listen, he don't even check his voicemails, because I'll say, I left you a voicemail. Oh, did you? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I do both, actually. Both. It depends on who it is.
Uh-huh.
You know, someone like my older members, I'll leave a voicemail.
Right.
Yeah, like in your situation. Right. I can understand.
But some of them I just hang up. I'm like, man, they're calling back if it's important, you know. But
just hang up.
Yeah, as long as, you know, especially... Because I know which ones pretty much got smartphones and which ones don't, you know. Pretty much if you got a smartphone, you're going to see a missed call from Pastor or, you know what I'm saying, or Bill. You know, they're going to see that. So, well, I missed your call, you know.
I'm just the opposite. I leave a voicemail so they don't call me back.
But see, the thing is, I do that sometimes too, because, you know.
You don't have to call me back.
Right. But they'll call you back anyway.
Because
they didn't check your voicemail.
Yeah. Right.
They seen you where you called.
That's why
I miss your call.
And I say I left you a voicemail.
Yeah. And they were like, oh, okay.
That's why I don't leave.
But then you got to turn around and say the same thing over again.
Yeah.
That's why I don't leave a
voicemail. Bill, I think you've hit the master thing there. Let's just don't leave voicemails no more.
Right.
And that, because you're gonna find out what we got to say.
I gotta go to a different app.
We can take voicemails off our phone.
Yeah,
they're just
obsolete.
Obsolete. Yeah.
Well, I gotta go to a different app. I gotta back out and do all this. I'm like, I ain't no.
Well, let me ask you this. And did you prefer calling somebody or texting them?
I'm a caller.
Okay. What about you, Bill?
I'm a texter.
I'll have to say I'm some of both. It depends on who it is.
I can do both.
Because there's some that you can't get off the phone with, right. So I'm going to text them. And then there's some,
and
I just,
you know, sometimes I feel like talking and sometimes I don't.
But see, I want to hear your voice.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm saying? I want to hear.
The inflections.
Yeah, I can tell through your voice if something's wrong. Or, you know, you're happy or not. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And something about your voice, especially when I talk to Bill on the phone.
And words can be taken
voice.
A different way.
Right.
Because I had someone text me one day and ask me something to do at the church.
Mm-hmm.
And
wait
a minute. And my,
okay, go ahead.
My response to that was, okay, whatever. Like, whatever you want to do is fine with me.
Right.
And the person texts back and said, what do you mean, whatever? Does that mean that, I mean, it was like,
right.
And then I had to say,
whatever
you want to do is fine, because they couldn't.
Right. They were like, they were thinking you would be nasty.
Whatever.
Yeah, right. The tone of what
and
I meant.
And that's because, like, when, say, when, if I'm texting Sean and he puts laugh out loud, I hear his laugh.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, and that's what people hear. They, your text, they, you know.
Right.
It's like that Mimi going around with the fellas from Orange County Chopper, mm-hmm. you know, and up put yeah, different yeah, things. Yeah. I hear them talking. Yeah, I hear them saying that. Yeah. So, and people get that in their head.
Do
they
you
hear
see
your
what
voice.
Mike Fogarty left for you?
Oh, no.
He said, I leave messages on Bill's phone.
Yeah. Speaking of Mike Fogarty, I left a message on his phone last week. Never heard back from him. So.
He didn't call you back.
Yeah, and it kind of broke my heart.
Oh, no. Not
for
Mike.
Because I thought something happened with him. Because it had been on Facebook. And I said, oh, Lord, he got the Rona.
Hey, Jet said selective.
Selective.
It's like you look at it and go, oh, I'm not answering the call right now.
And y'all know we all do that. Don't try that like y'all so spiritual. Y'all don't do that. Because you know there's some people call you be like, oh, I can't do it right now.
Right.
You know?
You don't have time.
Right. Because you know it's 18 minutes of your life right there.
Right. I know my daughters. And I'm calling out both my daughters. They'll sit there and look at that phone and see daddy, and they won't answer that
phone.
We
say this all the time. We call our kids and none of them answer. And I'm like, and you know the phone's right there in your pocket or your hand. Yeah. Don't even try to lie. Mm-hmm. That, you know.
Michael said he did call you back.
Oh, but you did not. I'll check, and I'll apologize, but because I was looking forward to it.
But see, here's the thing with my kids.
Did you leave a message?
Here's the thing with my kids. Because, you know, except my son now, he pays his own bill. But before then, I always told them. Because I
paying for it.
We call, and sometimes they wouldn't answer.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I was like, okay, if you don't ask your mama, that's on you. That's between you and your mama. But when you see my number pop up, oh, you better get on that phone, you know. And so now sometimes my wife will be like, I try to call the kids, and they didn't answer. You call them. And then I'll call, they'll answer. You know, and Missy's like, well, it is for you. And I said, I done threatened him. I'm paying that bill.
Uh-huh.
You know, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away.
You got that right.
Daddy going to give
it out the window.
You know? And Lord, I don't want to take that out of context because people be calling me. I didn't mean it like that. You know,
we got you.
But anyway.
Yeah, because I wanted to stress that your morning manna is all about joy.
Mm-hmm.
We just like to bring some fun.
Yeah, yes. We share joy on the airways of WCC 99.9.
You know, Williston. Guys, it's Monday morning. We have enough heaviness going on in the world anyway.
Right.
And so laughter. Scripture tells us
it's
a medicine.
Medicine
and joy.
Amen.
And laughter. And so we just
and if you can't laugh at yourself,
who can you laugh
at? I mean, exactly.
Oh, speaking of laughter, if y'all have not got the app yet, please go to the app store and get the Chosen. C H O S E N. Get the Chosen app. Watch the videos. It's the life of Jesus. You can for $15 you can share it with like 10 people will actually get to watch the episodes.
They're called Pay It Forward.
Yeah, Pay It Forward. It's just absolutely wonderful.
It really is.
It's
good.
God-led. It's all about God. 100% of what they make go into making the series, and you can really tell it.
Yeah, and we can't wait for the next one to
start. It's one of the best put-together Christian series I've ever had the pleasure of watching and being a part of. So, get it, because it, you know, and it shows Jesus is being serious and funny, you know. And I like stuff like that.
Me too.
There's eight.
And it's based on Jesus' life, the scripture, but they do some things we don't know. So they do their best educated guess of what.
Right. So some of the characters that we don't know until they're mentioned in scripture anything about their life prior.
Right.
So they say we took liberties on this person.
Right.
Until this point when they met Christ, and then, you know, the scripture. So it's really good.
But that's the whole thing. A lot of people get so, I hate you, Pharisaic about it.
Right.
You know, this is not lining up with the word. The word don't say that, you know.
Right.
The word don't say nothing about it. It ain't that the word, like they're altering the word.
Right.
We just don't have any clue about that. I mean, you think about Jesus' life. You see him at birth.
And then you hear
you see him at 12. And then you don't see him again at 30.
And a lot of stories you take as being in the Bible or not.
Exactly.
They're in the stuff that was taken out the Bible.
Right.
And been passed down. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
From your mama Bible. My mama said.
My mama said.
So anyway, The Chosen is a good
it's phenomenal
thing. And during this time of incubation and reflection and study, you need to watch. It's really, really
good. The first season's eight. Raising money now for the second season.
Yeah, and I love it because when you put the first episode on, it says, this episode brought to you by, just say, Sean from South Carolina because you donated $15.
Oh,
and so the next person that gets to watch it would see
10 people will see your name up there.
And then the next person, you know, might turn on and say, this episode was brought to you by from so-and-so in North Dakota or whatever. It's just really cool.
That's cool.
So,
And they, you can donate from $14.99 up to $100,000 or more. And they tell you what you get with it. But
it's cool.
It's, I just can't, I can't cover it vocally what it means to me, because the very first episode had me in tears, and I watched it without Dana, and I told her, I was like, you've got to come home and watch the series. It's just unreal.
It was really, really good. So here's my next question. Since we're on movies here, I have to ask people, and mainly, maybe I shouldn't say movies. I'm gonna go back to a book. How many of you that are watching on Facebook or listening on the radio have ever read the book, The Pilgrim's Progress? Because I have been shocked at the amount of people that go, huh?
Mm-hmm. That's where I'm at.
You're at, huh? Okay.
You've never heard of it? Okay.
Okay, so.
It's only the second book
most
behind
sold,
the Bible.
Yeah, behind the Bible. So John Bunyan wrote this book. John Bunyan seriously wrote this book.
Now that's not Paul.
I was going to say, is that his brother?
No. 304. It's 340 years ago.
Three centuries ago.
Three centuries. He wrote it while in prison, being persecuted for actually questioning the religious leaders in his churches and what they were doing and what was going on. And he was in prison. So
Chet said it should be required to join a church.
Right. The book is an allegory, which is kind of like a parable for those that don't know what allegory is, and he talks about this man, and he's making this journey from the city of destruction where he lives, where he's being persecuted, trying to get to the king, to the celestial city. So that gives you, and all along his journey, he's carrying this heavy burden and he's trying to find out how he can get rid of the burden, and he meets, faithful, he meets hope, he also meets
undecided, or they use a different word,
worldliness, and all these characters along the way,
pliable,
and to make it on his journey. I'm telling you, if you've never read it, you need to read it.
You've got to realize it was written three centuries ago, so it's old English,
but
simplistic.
But right
compared
now,
to what we're used to.
Right now, if you have Prime Video, if you're a member of Prime, you can go, and they've got a new, brand new animated one they just done for children, just released this past year, of The Pilgrim's Progress. And we watched it the other day because I wanted to see.
Well, I might have to watch that.
Let me tell you, I encourage everybody that has kids.
Don't watch the movie.
Not the real movie.
The cartoon is a lot better than the movie. The movie
That's
was
what I'm saying. I want to watch the cartoon.
Because they're all on Prime, but the cartoon was made specifically. The American Family Association had been really trying to shoot it out there. Get this movie, sit down with your kids and watch this movie.
And it's a simple,
it's because the
gospel of Jesus is not anything
hard.
It's
not complicated. No.
Yeah.
And it's very simple, and you got to remember this was written 300 years ago, so it's even more simple.
Yeah, and the thing, the characters he meets along the way, the names and stuff in the allegory, and how they might lead him off this path, and he may go this path.
Oh, he takes the wrong path a couple times,
and the shepherd says, didn't I tell you to stay on this path?
Stay on this path.
It is so good. So it's on Prime Video or it's on Facebook. You can sign up for it free, and then, you know, hook up your phone, sling it to your TV, or however you do that. For those that do that. But if you got children, even adults, I encourage you to please go watch it, The Pilgrim's Progress.
Scott, remember that. We got to watch that.
It's really good. It really is, for a cartoon, for animated. Watch all the way to the end, because they start singing the gospel songs at the end, and it says this book was written while he was in prison, you know, and it says, such and such, 17, whatever, 340 years ago,
so he
and it's
spent
only
about 13 years
in prison.
Over.
Yeah, because he dared to challenge and question what the religious leaders were doing.
He wanted to see the word for himself.
Yeah,
not just listen to the past.
What was funny, you know, he was talking about the chosen thing. I was telling, actually, Robbie Dawkins, one of the guys that I saw at that conference. I got lady goes to my church. She was one of my spiritual friends that we, you know, stay in contact with. She said she sent me a video, and it was an excerpt out of The Chosen. And I told her, I said, well, that came from The Chosen. I said, you need to download this thing and watch it. And so, and she had heard about it. I forgot it. But anyway, she sent me a message the other night and said, this thing is so good.
Yeah.
She said, this thing's,
I'm going to watch it again.
She said, this thing's got me hooked like I used to be hooked on The Young and the Restless.
Right. I'm telling you, it's really, really good. Good morning, Yohani.
And the thing, good morning, brother. Miss you and love you. The thing I was amazed about, because I when like the fellas portraying Jesus, I Googled him. I wanted to see, you know, what his history was. Because to me, he was, I was hearing more Italian versus what I thought Jesus would sound
right.
like. But he is he's famous for dialects. Like if you want Italian, he'll give you, you know, real Italian. If you want, you know, English, he'll give you, you know, so accents and dialects. And he researched that area that Jesus was, born in and
how they spoke.
History of it. So he developed
how
the accent and the dialects.
That's great.
So it's not something just thrown together like most, you know, because you've got a lot of Christian shows that are just sad. You know, that's the only way to describe them. Sad. Good message, but sad. They really put forth a wonderful
effort.
It's really
good. It really is.
Because the grandson of one of the fellas that wrote the Left Behind series, Jenkins, the grandson of Jenkins is Dallas Jenkins, who's the one doing it. And he's done a lot of movies.
So I tell you what's pretty cool too is, and I heard now whether this is truth or not, but they were going to get together. Mel Gibson was going to do a sequel to The Passion of the Christ. And I'm kind of interested to see.
Filming now.
Yeah. So I'm interested to see how that's going to.
The Christ, you know, that one was, ended. This one's going to be his return.
Right.
It's going to be like, can you imagine?
I mean, they did such a good job on that one. You know, I don't. Y'all remember when that came out? It was.
We watched it all.
Every year. We watched it the other night before Easter, and watching that.
I've seen that movie probably 15 times.
I mean, like it's almost like you couldn't bear to look upon it.
It was so powerful, and it still is.
Yeah, and I told Dana, I said, the bad thing is this is a movie. In real life, it was really bad.
Exactly.
It wasn't, you know, but yeah, I can't.
But I mean, you think about it. Here Jesus was with, well, might as well say 11 followers because Judas has already betrayed him, you know. But none of them.
Well, at that time, Judas was sorry. He did wrong.
Yeah, you know? But I mean.
And what's really bad is he wasn't supposed to be like that. You know, the head guy did not tell them to do that. They did it, you know, pretty much on their own out of, you know, meanness, I think. But it's just, bless his heart.
But I'm just, you know, I find it hard to believe. And I say hard to believe. I don't want to say hard to believe. But I know, I want to say if I was there, they would have killed me.
Right.
Because I'd have went.
Off,
you know. They,
but see,
you know,
we know the end of the story. They didn't.
No.
Then
exactly.
See, it's easy to look at it now because
exactly.
we know.
Exactly. We could have been Peter. Yeah, honestly.
But I think I would have still done something. I'm not going to stand around when someone gets beat down like that. Regardless.
Well, you know.
But I mean, under fear and everything happening, not, I mean, you know, you're going to die.
Well, I say that simply because you had people cheering him coming in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A week later.
Yeah, and then you're going to turn that quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know. If he'd have gave me sight, I'd have gave my life for him.
Exactly.
If he'd done anything for me.
That's why I'm at.
If my mama was one with bleeding issues, I'd have gave my life for him. You know?
It kind of reminds me of that. We read a book called, and we were looking for it this morning. It's called Search for the Nail Print.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And it's about these three people that journey back into Israel in his time. They don't mean they were going to Israel in modern day to travel, and they end up going in this one building, and it translates them back to the time of Jesus. So they're following around with all this that's going on, and because they know the Bible and they're watching what's going on, they're going, why are they doing this? Don't do that. Don't deny him. Don't, you know, whatever.
It's funny because they were showing the apostles as like real people, you know?
Because
you got to remember. Because I think it's funny, you know, when they were in the wilderness, they had, you know, fire at night and mm-hmm. smoke cloud, you know, and they still go ahead and make that cow, you know, mm-hmm.
yeah,
piss some gold.
What? Yeah,
man, you come on, what, you didn't learn nothing, mm-hmm. you know? So.
Hey, you just, wait a minute, didn't he just deliver you all those plagues and all yeah. the death? I mean, you know, all the things.
You're going to build a cow that quick? Come on, it's man. Funny.
Yeah, that would be me if I was in that same situation.
Yeah.
You know, somehow got transported back to that time, I'd have been like.
But they would, yeah, but see, they all had the Bible, so they'd whip out yeah. the Bible. Well, it was blank.
It was blank, yeah, because it hadn't been written yet. Yeah, it was so.
But they had the head knowledge, yeah. but they didn't have the book knowledge.
Yeah, everything that had happened was there. In the book, but. Everything else.
Everything that was well, progressing oh, would appear in the Bible. It was really good.
That'd book. Make a good movie right there.
Yeah.
Well, the fellow that wrote it, I think it was going to be a series of three or four books. Well, he stopped at the first one.
And listen, let me tell you how the first book ended. This is so cool, and I can do this now because we kept looking to find the sequel.
Mm-hmm.
So they're in this big battle, whatever, and they finally go back into this room, this inn, and all of a sudden they're translated back to modern Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Like where they were there yeah. to tourists, but it's at the last page. Old it says Sam. One of the disciples, was it Peter?
I thought it was Paul.
But Paul, I don't know. Anyway,
no, it was
came back with
yeah,
them
I think it was
to
Peter.
Modern Israel.
Yeah, he's behind a
and that's
basket.
The way the book ended. So we
he
were
stood up, said, ooh.
So we were waiting. We were waiting for
oh,
that.
Oh, cuz got to come out with another book then,
right,
bro.
Yeah. Right. Man, we were so disappointed because oh. we was like, this
now,
is
the coolest
so good.
Thing, the only reason I bought the book, I didn't even look at the book. I just grabbed it and said, I want this book. It's a real pretty book, but it's got a picture of a hand and it's got a hole in it. And that hole goes all the way through the book.
Yeah, through the book. Every page has got that hole, the nail print through the book.
Yeah. And I had to have
so
the
that's
book.
Why you bought the book.
Yeah.
Really?
Because Dana's like, awesome. What's it about? And I said, I don't care. It's a Christian book and it's got a hole all the way through
and
I want
listen,
the book.
And listen, here's how it was presented in the store. It was on a cross. And they were all hanging. All the
on
books were hanging on a nail. Through that nail print. It was cool. It was up in Gatlinburg. We were up there with Pastor and Sister Schaefer.
Never seen it. Never seen it since.
I know, right?
So, you know, after we read it, I Googled to see when the sequel was coming out.
Because we couldn't wait.
It's not. Now, this has been quite a few years ago. So
I guess we could check and
yeah,
see.
Yeah, he might have three
man,
or four books.
You turn over that last page and says, yeah, we made it back to Israel. We're back home. We're safe where we're supposed to be. And then it says, and then the next page, you flip it over and it says, and so-and-so.
Because I went as far as looking for him on Facebook. Oh, no, he didn't. He going to write a sequel.
Oh, yeah.
You going to send me your transcript.
Yeah, either that or you going to call me and tell me what's in your head because I need to know.
I'm going to write it.
Yes, sir. That's good stuff, man. I'll tell you.
Okay, so we're going to do a word today.
Okay.
Here's our word of the day.
Word of the day.
Y'all going to learn a word today.
I ain't got a pen today.
I'll get it.
I'll grab it.
Here we go.
In the drawer. No,
I'll get
them. Here. I got y'all too. Right here.
Bartlett.
Blatterstay.
Kerfuffle.
Manuka.
These been sanitized.
Yeah, I licked them.
What is it at the end? It's time for word of the day. Yay, everybody
can't tell she's been married before.
Okay, guys, so here is your word of the day. I was going to do something different, but then I decided not to. This is our word, baffle-gab.
Baffle?
Baffle-gab.
Okay.
So you can go ahead and spell it.
Boop, boop, boop.
Anytime y'all ready, baffle-gab.
Okay. Well, I went with hooked on phonics, so I spelled it with a baffle-gab.
Okay.
I did the same thing.
Same thing? Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Y'all spelling is correct.
Oh,
y'all
got
check.
It
right.
Put a check.
Check.
I think
that's
the first
time
I looked
at it. My first time.
Oh, where my bell at?
Now, this is what's going to be fun. I want to know what your definition is.
Okay. Well, just right off the top of my head, gab is talk.
Okay.
You know, so okay. I'm going to go with talking, but in a baffling way, like when I make up answers. I baffle with, you know, with my brilliance.
Yeah,
I baffle gab. And basically it's just talking in circles more or less.
Talking in circles, yeah. Okay. What about
you? I was going to say, you know, talking in a confusing kind of way.
Okay.
You know, just kind of random.
Random talk.
So
right.
It's basically the same thing.
Yeah.
So we're going for two.
Mm-hmm. Y'all
two
both
for two.
On the same
come
page,
on.
Okay. Yeah. So the word, here's exactly what it says. It's jargon filled talk.
That's us, Paul.
That sets out to clarify something,
mm-hmm.
but ends up only confusing things.
We did it, Paul.
We did it.
We did it. Two for two, Paul.
So, Baffle,
where April Babb at? Where's April Babb?
So here's the reason I picked this word today, because of all the talking we've been doing.
Out of 168 shows, we're going to write that down. 168 is the show.
Number 168, y'all got the word of the day correct.
Every aspect of it.
Yeah, right? The spelling.
Spelling and definition.
But I thought that was so funny. Jargon-filled talk that sets out to clarify something, but only ends up confusing it more.
I think it's funny because it shouldn't have meant that based on all your other words of the day.
Right.
It should have been something totally different.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
But, well, yeah. You know, when you're baffled about something, it's like you can't figure it out. It's like that baffles me. I can't figure it out. Mm-hmm.
I've been baffled
gabbing is talking. Yes.
Well, I'm 56, so probably started talking when I was about
two. Some people are pros at baffle gabbing.
Oh, yeah.
That's a word that mm-hmm. we can use from
baffle gabbing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to use that today on Skylar or Missy riding down the road. Yeah, quit baffle gabbing.
Yeah, any of the Turners that are watching, you know what baffle gab is. All
right. Hey, and you can say that. Preachers can baffle gab.
Oh, yeah. I've done it a bunch of times.
You're trying to say something and it just makes it more mm-hmm. confusing, you mm-hmm. know, or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Right. I remember the first time I came on this show when we came on here with the band and we did this word of the day. And, you know, I never didn't know Bill that well, you know. And Bill comes out with this, in England in 1694, you know, and he's like, I'm like, this dude is got it. I mean, he's like a history buff. And he was baffle gabbing the whole time, and I didn't realize it.
Now, I am a history buff, but a lot of times I ad lib history.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
I make
but
history,
you're really good at it, though.
I make history fun.
You do.
Yeah. He makes it fun, and he makes it up.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of that,
speaking of
let
history,
me change the camera so we can get you.
Now, this is I'm glad she had an easy word of the day, because this is an easy one.
Oh Lord, he always says
Dana,
that,
you already you know exactly what it is already.
It always scares me when he says
which one is on? Okay, that one.
Oh, I know what that is. That's the can I say it?
If you know it, go ahead.
That's the fire hydrant they got in Columbia.
What is it though?
It's a fire hydrant that they made it, and it looks like it's.
It's the world's. Hit.
World's
largest
fire hydrant. Yeah,
but it really
it's
works
in Columbia.
I don't know about working, but it's the world's largest. That's what they claim.
No.
Okay. Dana, you.
I remember seeing it. Yes, I do. It's somewhere over by that bridge painting.
The tunnel vision.
Yeah, yeah, thank you. Yeah.
It's on Taylor Street in Columbia, South Carolina.
Okay.
It's right across from Tunnel Vision, which is a painting on the side of a building in Columbia, South Carolina. It looks like a real tunnel. If you've never been to Taylor Street to see Tunnel Vision, you need to, because when you turn around and put your back to Tunnel Vision, you can see the world's largest fire hydrant. That's just a little South Carolina history. Now, I don't know if it really works or not, but I'm going to say it does work, and they've had to use it on several fires in downtown Columbia.
I would bite on that. Not. You remember, I don't know if y'all remember or not, but going to school in South Carolina, we had to study South Carolina history.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to watch this show on TV.
On PBS, probably.
Yeah. And they'd come on and they would sing, "We are good sand lappers. Yes, we're good sand lappers."
Yeah. I remember. I do remember that.
That and the Reading Rainbow. Remember Reading Rainbow?
I remember Reading mm-hmm. Rainbow, but I don't remember that.
I know what you remember. This is a bill, and I'm sitting on Capitol Hill.
Yep. I remember that.
Rock.
Yeah.
Hey, if it weren't for that, I wouldn't know.
Schoolhouse Rock.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah, I wouldn't know hardly anything.
Yeah, so I'm with you. Man, that's some good
And that's
stuff.
Really the only one I remember because it had Bill in it.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
I'm just a Bill and I'm sitting on Capitol Hill. But everything, conjunction,
yeah.
What's your function?
Yeah.
Put words and phrases that end.
And I'm dating myself. Well, no, no,
they still show them sometimes.
They just recently stopped it. Mm-hmm. I think a couple of years ago because the fella that was doing it passed.
It makes me think of that meme that's on Facebook. Did y'all see the one where the mother was teaching her child, you know, with these packages they're sending home and mm-hmm. they're doing homeschooling? And it says before COVID-19, and it had the, what they call that math that they're doing now, that
Common Core,
and yeah. It had this thing. And then it says after COVID-19, and it had 12 plus 12 equal 24. Instead of this big old long problem.
Exactly.
It was before COVID-19 and after COVID-19.
They said kids are going to come back to school a whole lot smarter than
they. Yeah, you got that right. Learning math the regular way.
It don't make no sense.
They said all these parents got guns. Ain't been no school shooting yet.
No, sir. I read one the other day. It said you need to teach your kids to have their school stomach. Because they don't get up in the middle of class and go to nobody's refrigerator and get something to eat.
Right.
You can save on groceries. From 8 to 3, you don't touch that.
Did you have, I'm going to see if I can do this, y'all. It was the funniest thing. There was a video that we shared on Facebook. And I'm going to see if I can go find it because, to me, it's hysterical. Of a woman with her kids. She's lining them up to go somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And,
I think my
daughter-in-law shared it because my son tagged me in it and said, "This is you, Mama."
Yeah. While you're looking for it, I just want to thank all our listeners for tuning in today. I know it's been a while since we've been on, and trust me, we've hated the fact that we couldn't come on because it's it's an extremely important part of my life.
I got a friend of mine from Mississippi watching.
Excellent. Yeah. I had a cousin, Jerry Lynn. She was watching my mom. Columbia.
Jimmy Whitley. Thank you, buddy.
Yeah, just we appreciate y'all so much because you're the reason why we do this and to share the joy of Jesus. So, and Dana's getting ready to do something. What you doing?
I know. I will say this too. You're talking about all the lives and stuff that preachers are doing. I got a message yesterday from a lady in New York.
Wow.
That said that they enjoyed the service. And
well, there you go.
You know, so.
I mean, that's worth.
It's pretty cool.
Everything. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now this video. It's just a funny video, y'all. So take it for what it's worth. We're not dissing anybody or anything. It's just fun.
Bring some laughter,
it's hilarious because I can see my mama and this woman. And if you hadn't done some of these in this video, you're not a parent.
Right. So here we go. Okay, y'all ready?
Yeah.
Hey, wait. Let me explain something to you before we leave. When we get over here, get somewhere and sit down. Don't talk to me. Don't look at me. Don't think about me because I'm grown. I'm going to be with the grown folks. You go be with the kids. Understand this. When I say it's time to go, it's time to go. Don't ask can you stay the night. You cannot. Don't ask can they come back over here and stay the night. They cannot. Don't get over here acting like you hungry, like you ain't ate all day. If you do, I'm going to knock fire out of your throat. Don't touch nothing. Don't break nothing. Don't ask for nothing to drink. Don't ask for nothing to eat. Lisa ain't already think her kids is better than everybody else, and they are not. If one of them touch you, you better knock their head off their shoulder. Don't come in there tattling to me about what you think, what you want, and how you feel. When we get ready to go, I tell you how you feel. Is everybody on the same page? Don't play with me.
So my daughter-in-law shared that, and my son tagged me in it. I'm like, are you kidding me? You think that's me?
Because so many of those things I did to my mother.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You
know, and I learned not that I only did them once, I should mm-hmm. say.
You got that right.
Because she ain't play either.
Yeah.
She never stood me up like that, but she let me know right quick what not to do after I done it.
Yeah,
You know that's right.
Been there, done that.
I asked my mama one time.
If you could.
Yeah, if my friend Mary Helen could spend the night. And she said, no, not tonight. Maybe another time. We got, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so me and Mary Helen devised a plan that when her mama got there to pick her up, I'd ask my mama again in front of her mama.
Mm.
Yeah.
In hopes that, you know, that would break her down. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it broke her down all right. It broke out that belt. And when they left, because I said, Mama, can Mary Helen spend the night? And she, and I saw, you know, it's like that when the eye.
Oh, it started twitching her.
She said, honey, no, not tonight. And I mean, she's looking at me this whole time, and I'm thinking, I'm dead.
Oh, yeah.
I am so dead right now.
And I messed up.
I messed up. And they left, and she wore my behind out with that belt.
I told you before they got here.
And I can promise
you,
guess what I never done again?
Me.
I think that's the problem with a lot of the youth nowadays, that the parents never follow through with what they meant.
When your parents spanked you, though, did they always hit you on every syllable or every word?
Oh, yeah.
I told you not to do that.
Luckily, my father was not the
disciplinary.
Yeah, he wasn't that. But my mother, she would take you out in a heartbeat. She would hit you with anything that was close by.
Oh, yeah. Because
I've had, you know, beatings with brushes.
Switch, fly swatter.
And, you know, I tell people this and they think, oh, my God, you would be. But, I mean, she hit me with a hanger a couple times, you know, because that was the closest thing. She and that iron, and I would prefer a hanger versus an iron.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Especially long.
Yeah. Because this one fella said, my mother beat me with an extension cord. And I started laughing. I said, yeah, I had that too. You know. But the kids nowadays, they thinking, what?
My grandma, from the story I was told, my grandmama grabbed, I don't know if it was my mom or somebody, but she got one of them with the coffee pot cord. She ripped it out.
Because back then the percolators come apart.
She ripped that thing out and wore them out, you know.
Yeah, so, buddy.
Whole
good time.
Generation.
Thank good God. By the time I was young, my grandma got old. She didn't do me that way. But
well, my children, you know.
But I respected them though. You know, they didn't.
Right.
I don't ever remember my grandmama or granddaddy really having to get on to me or my brother. Well, it was just a fear.
I disrespected. I disrespected my father one time when I was 15, and I woke up in the tub with a piece of meat on my eye. So. I didn't do that again, you know, so. And I didn't hate him for it or nothing. I said, I don't need to say that again.
Yeah.
I had that meat on my eye.
My brother used to be real bad about standing behind the door and scaring mama, you know, when she come in. And one time he done it, boy, and mama caught him, boy. He got up off the floor. He didn't do that no more.
So, anyway.
Good times right there.
Guys, thank you for today for joining us. All y'all on Facebook.
Yes.
I know we've gabbed a lot today. We baffle gabbed
a lot.
Well, that's because we ain't seen each other.
It's been great, though.
We've had a lot of stuff going on, a lot of things to talk about.
Hey, Stephanie.
Don't forget the upcoming show we'll be talking to you about. April and I are going to do soon. Don't forget about, we've got a couple announcements. May 11th through the 15th on Perry Stone's Network on the Facebook or YouTube. He's going to do old time Holy Ghost revival. Man, I cannot wait. Judy Jacobs is going to be there doing the music. And we also have an announcement. Miss Donna King was supposed to be our guest here today, and she couldn't come today because of this. Pastor has asked us not to have a lot of guests in the studio. So we decided to honor what he said, and I wanted to announce the third annual Field Overflowing Golf Tournament. They've moved it to September 19th at the Pine Ridge Country Club in Edgefield.
Excellent.
It's 8:30 a.m. is Captain's Choice, 7:30 a.m. registration. They still have a need for, let's see, there's door prizes and drawings and all kind of stuff. Let me.
So if you were planning on sponsoring them before, you need to call them again.
It says there's a new date. We need tee box sponsors and have enough slots for 8 more golf teams.
Right.
Thanks.
So,
and the date, and much love to you from Donna and them. And if you need to get in touch, I'm going to give you her number.
Well, just put it on, and we'll put it on our Facebook page.
Put it in the feed too, but it's 803-221-9787. Or Stephanie, 803-215-7542.
That's Stephanie King.
Stephanie King. So we'll put those numbers in the feed, too. But if you have any questions and missed any of that, you can also email us at morningmanna999@gmail.com, and we'll get you all that info.
And Stephanie King is Donna King's beautiful daughter.
Yes.
And we love you, too, sweetie.
And so don't forget, guys, next week, Miss April will be here and the ladies.
Hopefully.
And we'll have a good show. Yeah.
Good Lord willing.
We've had so much going on, and her having to teach all her kids and everything has been quite challenging. And I hope
pray for her children.
Yeah. And like we said at the beginning of the show, pray about these evangelists and these ones out there, like
please.
Jeffrey and Chris. You know, if you feel led to, you know, sow into their ministry at this time, would probably be a great time for you to do that.
Absolutely.
To help them out.
Yeah, if you've got the funds, please bless them because they're in dire needs. And we've got to look out for our evangelists.
Yes, we do. And with that, we're going to be out of here.
Love you guys.
Thank y'all so much for listening. We've been blessed by it, and we will look forward to seeing y'all again real soon.
Thank you for tuning in to 99.9 WUCC Williston. We love you and we appreciate you and we're praying for you.
All right. Thank you for all you watching us on Facebook, those you listening on 99.9 FM, for all our awesome sponsors. We thank God for you, each and every one of you. Yes, and we speak blessing over you today. Yes. And those that are listening, we speak blessing over
you
today.
And if you've got a Christian business, please call us. We'd love to have you.
We love you. And we're love out of here. Bye, guys.
This is Jace Turner, and you are listening to the Voice of Truth Station, WUCC 99.9.